everyone chasing down, gets a drop, and the knife comes in! Simple, of course, stabs him straight in the chest.
So aggressive late, Dennis catches him off! That's ungodly from Dennis!
Oh my God, that awareness, the timing works out perfectly, just like that.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to our penultimate show of season one. It's crazy to think that the time has expired so quickly as we are now on episode 5 of 6. Yeah.
It is kind of nuts, isn't it? It has flown by with all the work and studio stuff we've been doing. We finally have made it to number 5. We have one more to go. And it's quite a special one today as well because we have none other than the Thunder from Down Under. It's Chad Burchill. How are you?
G'day, Counter. Yeah.
Actually, it's fun.
Straight in there.
I knew it was going to happen. You could totally go nuts. Oh. I think everyone needs to notify everyone that he can say cunts, he can say assholes, whatever
else you
say.
Pretty tame, really.
Yeah, SPUNJ on the show.
Fuck you, man.
How have you been finding Cologne?
Yeah, it's nice. The weather's been good. Yep. My apartment's been average as fuck, but, you know, moldy bread and potatoes.
Ours is pretty sick. I don't know why yours sucks.
Yeah, I don't know, because I'm about 40 minutes away by tram.
What about, have you found analyst stuff, casting? Been good?
It's all right. Being with you guys is good. You know, you're not giving me any feedback if I'm good or bad at it, so I'm just fucking...
Honestly, we don't listen. I hardly watch the games that I cast myself, so...
It's true. If you ask Matt about a game he just casted, he's just like, I can't really remember the rounds. Like, he's just kind of like seeing what he sees, and it kind of leaves his brain instantly.
Yeah. So, at a point, you just get overload. You've done so many games in a year. I try and remember the big ones on the lands, you know, semifinals at majors, the Star Ladder final, but some of the online stuff, I don't know.
Do you think you'll be sticking around as analysts?
I want to keep trying, you know, if I can...
I think you're doing a good job, honestly.
I think you
did a very good job at DreamHack.
I think all right.
Thanks, Matt.
You're welcome.
So what you haven't heard, I've done a good job at.
Yeah. Well, see, the thing is, I don't like to give anyone any...
credit?
Exactly.
Why?
Because I'm an asshole.
Okay.
But you're doing all right.
But this is the real test now. You're on your first podcast.
And I can swear.
And you can swear.
The real me comes out now.
How could you ruin the career in the first week with us? That would be good.
I'll stay away from anything racist or sexist or homophobic.
Yes. Not that you wouldn't say anything like that.
No, you never would.
I'm not going to say anything controversial. Yeah.
Right. Good. We cleared all the rules. And now, Matthew.
Let's get comfortable, boys.
Oh, it's that kind of show.
I thought he was just going to start whipping us. All right, rules are off. Like, Jesus. You look great without pants, I have to
Thank
say.
You.
You look very good without pants. You don't look as good without pants.
I have really hairy legs.
You have really hairy arms too, so that makes sense.
Why are your arms so hairy?
I don't know, it's a weird genetic
thing.
What
about that area though?
The pubic region?
Yeah.
I trim it. So I don't know if it's more or less than anybody else.
No afro though, there's no jungle.
No, it's not nuts.
Australian worms living
in
there.
Well, there are nuts, but it's not out of control.
Oh, I see. All right, cool. Yes, formalities. Obviously, we've done our introduction, but we do, as always, have to thank our lovely sponsors. Remember, season one, this whole show would not have been possible without the support of these very special people. So first and foremost, obviously, Space Jam. We mentioned it. They're really trying to get into esports. They're a non-endemic brand, which I've ranted about in the past. You can look it up. I think it's documented. My opinions on some of that stuff. We've got a cough button for Henry, so we can actually go full Vape Nation. Oh, wait. It's this.
No, it's this.
It's that. You don't have to hear it. They're non-endemic, which means that they're not gamers selling to gamers, which means there's a potential. That only grows so much. That's all internal, right? But as soon as we bring in these external guys that really want to help out esports, that's when we're going to hit the next level. So it's really cool that Space Jam's trying to get on. They gave us the freedom to do whatever we wanted to do. I have to admit, it smells very good. But it's also... it's really cool to see them teaming up with Luminosity, some COD stuff they've done in the last couple of weeks. So I'm excited that they're on board.
Yeah, definitely. And then we move on to guys like Darkin, who
I like this shirt, actually.
You're actually a big fan of them. Like, most of the time you'll be wearing that gear.
So yeah, oddly enough, one of the reasons we reached out to them is because we also wanted brands that we believed in. And on Reddit, people were saying like, oh, it's a fashion brand. Why is fashion and gaming? Why this? Why that? You know, it's expensive. It is fashion and gaming. That's the cool part for me. And I've always been, I think you know this too, Chad.
Why are people complaining about fashion and gaming?
Well, that's the thing. Exactly. And people don't understand. Because they're all saying like, those two things don't go together. Well, who says?
This is a lifestyle now, right?
It's Darkin says they do.
You're not in your basement anymore just playing. You know, people are proud
of
what they do.
It's one of the biggest industries in the world.
Yeah. And that's also one of the cool things. People are proud of what they do. I can wear this and be proud that I'm a gamer. And when you see it, you know it's gaming. And it's like, hey, you're a gamer too. You don't know it's gaming. It's just a cool shirt. It's a cool design. So they are blurring that line, which I think is very, very cool. And now I stuck up for them a lot. I think most people know this, but I used to shoot fashion before I came into gaming. So it's kind of, for me, it's very cool to have someone that kind of hits both of the subcultures that I'm very interested in.
Absolutely. And finally, Fnatic gear as well. We've actually got a really cool giveaway coming up. Then we had the Flick of the Week last week. We've got something similar
right.
coming in, which I'm going to save for the
that
end.
That wasn't last week, by the way. That was like 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, when we first announced it, I think we did the winners last show, though. I think we did.
Two shows. Not,
we, two, yeah,
yeah,
we did
last
week.
Two shows.
That's right.
Yeah,
so we've got a really cool giveaway with the keyboard this time. We're going to save it for the end, so look out for that.
And obviously, our last sponsor I want to thank. I just want to get this in. I know I kind of cut it.
Go on.
We have to thank the Australian government for giving us a nice adopted refugee for this show, so it's good
we're
going to
look
here.
After him real nice.
I'm not here illegally. I'm on holidays.
Holidays.
Oh, right.
Not
right.
working,
holidays.
Just having a good time.
What are you here for? Just a holiday for
honestly,
5 weeks.
I say that every time.
Just
it's going
to
catch up with me.
Just going to the hotspots of Europe, Cologne.
Yeah, Cologne's the lovely place. I just hit it.
You didn't get to Kiev.
I didn't
Bucharest.
Get to Kiev. Yeah, Romania.
Going to all the hotspots.
Yeah, the taxi drivers are out of control.
Yeah, they are.
Oh, everyone drives like that there. It's great. When I rented a car there, it was so fun.
You rented a car there?
Yeah, I've driven all across Romania. I've driven like all the Transylvania. Anyone who knows anything about roads or watches Top Gear, Transfiguration, the best, highest rated road in the world for driving. I did that in a little Mazda Miata. It was great. That car, 50-50 weight distribution, 110 horsepower or whatever, not much. It's the right car to do that road on because you can drive the piss out of it. And when you're, 10 feet from a cliff or 4 inches from a cliff on the exit of a corner, it's not a fucking Porsche that's going to snap out on you all of a sudden. You can just go, I'm a little sideways. It's fine. It's only 110 horsepower. You're away with
I know fuck all about cars, but I think the three of us will do a better job at the new Top Gear lineup than the
except
current.
Except for Chris Harris. Chris Harris is fucking brilliant, but he's not on the main show. He only does the extras.
He just does like some little segments every week.
Chris Harris is the best.
It's all falling apart.
Car
Chris
journalist.
Evans, who's the main host, he's left already. So
was he a Ranger?
Yeah,
he was.
That's a redhead motherfucker for those playing at home.
Yeah,
I love that. Those playing at home session for those watching in black and white. For those playing at home, it's great.
Yeah.
In all seriousness, though, I think Chris Harris is the best automotive journalist of our generation. More so than Jeremy Clarkson, those guys, because he actually can drive and writes about the cars rather than entertainment.
A good segue from the best road in Romania. It's moving into our first subject. We actually were at DreamHack Bucharest. That's where your first event was, coming to analyze. And it was actually a pretty cool event overall, albeit some chocolate bars to the face. We actually had a very good time there.
Yeah, should we address that?
Let's just do it quickly.
Yeah, okay. So first and foremost, I felt a little bit guilty tweeting it out to overshadow a final in Virtus Pro. Winning, as a whole, last year when we were there, they kind of split it with Dota. And this year they did it just CS. So first and foremost, they were trying to build on that and help CS with more viewership. Cluj, it's opposite side of the country. A lot of students there, but it didn't have the greatest. It had good viewership. It had a good amount of people in the crowd, but it wasn't enough to fill this space. But by going back to DreamHack Romania or Bucharest, sorry, as it were, they wanted to commit to CS. Everything went fairly well. The problem is when I put out that tweet, everyone instantly already based on Richard Lewis's past, et cetera, points the finger at DreamHack as the problem. I want to clear that up first and foremost because that's not what I was saying. And I'm also not blaming Romania. I think Romania is a fantastic place. It's probably my favorite country that we go to each year. And it was just a few assholes in a crowd. In fact, the same people that were doing the clapping were the same people that threw the stuff. So there you go. It was literally two or three people. But it was just enough to be annoying that kind of ruins the event for other people.
The reason I was frustrated at that one, because obviously once you
I didn't even know you got hit, by
right,
the way.
So that's the thing, right? So once I get hit once and then twice, I'm kind of on edge the whole time I'm trying to cast. Like, it's very difficult to keep looking at a monitor and keep, like, processing all this information and talking at the same time. When you think you get hit in the face again by being suffering it, that's why I was pissed off, right? Everyone saw it at the end. Like, you even saw me that night. I wasn't really talking at all, right?
I give you credit for more patience than me. I would have got up and walked over to security and be like, get them the fuck out of here. Like, I wouldn't have.
It wasn't like a massive deal or anything. It's just like it just upset me because it affected my work and I couldn't do the best possible job I could do. That's why I got annoyed with it. Obviously, there's nothing to do with DreamHack. It's just like it's just one of those things, right? We're in the crowd. That's what we want to be. We ask every time to be within the crowd. Sometimes when you're backstage, it's not the same experience. And that will happen. If there are dickheads in the crowd, that's going to happen. And it got dealt with straight away. Once they found out who was doing the clapping and stuff like that, DreamHack sorted it out straight away. There's what, like 1,000, 2,000 people in there. It's very difficult to locate and pinpoint the exact person doing it. So
yeah, and that's the point I want to touch on. Because first and foremost, Loda, Richard Lewis backstage, that's where this all stems from.
Yeah.
Loda's always going to be back there. He's a player. Everyone knows him. He's Swedish. He knows the organization. Even if there's security, that's not going to stop Loda from going backstage. He kind of has a place back there, in my opinion.
Yeah.
The other one is Leipzig, where someone did rush the stage. That was an issue. And I think that happened again at another event previously as well. Austin, I think? Yeah, Austin had someone behind the stage, which was also DreamHack. Which
Leipzig was certainly the worst one in terms of like him coming on the stream and could have done anything,
I thought it was
right?
a DreamHack staff member.
Yeah.
I was hosting, and I was like, oh, here comes someone to fix something. And then all of a sudden, he starts yelling at a mic. I don't know if you remember this.
No, I don't.
He just came on and was, I forget what he said, like, Mouse Sports, motherfuckers, or something. And and then
He came on and said Sukablia, I think.
Sukablia, that's right. Yeah.
Some people are just fucking idiots, man. Like,
he was drunk. I think it was his birthday or something. That's what I heard. It was like his birthday that Tuesday. He was pissed.
It doesn't matter.
Like, yeah, it, obviously he doesn't understand. Like, he was just some idiot. Like, he was drunk. It's not like he was a premeditated attack. I don't think.
Yeah. So anyway, we're spending a little more time on this than I want to.
Yeah.
I know, Chad, you're not. You're here to talk about other things, but just to clear the air, DreamHack has improved security since the Leipzig incident. They do have people beside us on the desk. Like I said to Henry a second ago, I would have taken my headset off and gone to them. The hard part is when there's a huge crowd, how do you locate the one guy that's clapping? So basically they have microphones on the crowd. What they could have done, and I don't know if they did or not, I haven't talked to them, is they could have just turned off, I think there's three of them, turned off one, okay, clapping's still there, turn off two, clapping, turn off three. Okay, now they know he's in that section. Mm. But then they still have to go out and find the one kid. My hands are down here. Okay, my arms are moving, but good luck seeing that in a crowd, right? Yeah. So it's hard to find the person. And the first time the whistlers were happening, which I don't know if it's the same people or not, I texted Mark and was like, we're already on it. And they did. I looked at Mark. He was standing beside us looking to see if it was coming through our mics, and they had two other people walking the stairs.
Yeah.
The chocolate bar thing, same thing. One guy throws something. I've been at hockey games when a guy throws something and puts his arm back down. You're like, you know, goes on the ice, and the refs are like, oh, you know, we got to find it. Good luck. Yeah, like, yeah. It's hard. So that's not entirely on DreamHack. What is on DreamHack is to make sure that they dealt with it accordingly. And in that sense, they did try. So the one thing I will say is maybe the fans getting close to the stage. That sucks. The sign guy as well, that's also going to come up.
With that, just the sign thing.
Yeah, because you can have an opinion on this too. Well,
the photographers were saying that from the stage, you couldn't actually see out into the audience because the it was all lit. So you couldn't see the signs anyway. Plus, players are very rarely looking up at the crowd, maybe like in a pause when they're, you know, trying to reset or something. Otherwise, you're just fully focused on your monitor. So anybody who's sitting there, like, unless you've organized it beforehand, if you were going to go, okay, let's put a guy in the crowd and he's going to have a sign, he's going to sign, hold the sign up when they're doing something and that's going to notify us, you're not going to have it as obvious of they're going A or they're going B. Like, how stupid do you have to be? Yeah. Like, people are going to be cheating a bit more sophisticated than that, right?
Yeah. Orange tomato or something, like a code word. And this is the point. I made a Reddit post saying they don't have time to look. Okay, look, fuck yeah. Okay, they have 2 seconds to go like that, but it's like you're saying. The lights are there. They're focused. They don't have the figurative word of time. They're not going to make time to read a fucking sign.
Exactly.
And not only that, if you're a player and you see that sign and it's not someone you've put there, how do you know he's not a Cloud9 fan?
Exactly. Yeah.
Right? He could have been fucking
with you. Was definitely blown up way out of proportion, I think. Like, obviously, there was a sign. It was like, ooh, we've never seen that before, but it's not an epidemic, right? It's fine. We'll look at it a bit more in the future, the events, make sure no one's doing that, but I don't think it affected anything, and let's not go fucking nuts. It was fine, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway.
Not only that, we spotted it in the last two rounds, and DreamHack said they kicked him out as soon as they saw it, which would have been around that time. Yeah. I don't think he was there the whole game because the crowd only accumulates at the end when they're waiting for autographs. So it's highly unlikely that he was even there the whole game because he would have been by himself and then it would have been blatantly obvious.
Mm. Should we get into the good things about DreamHack?
Yes,
There was lots of amazing storylines at this event. I think in terms of an open, it actually delivered on many fronts in terms of the results and some of the storylines that were there. So we'll kick things off with Cloud9. Bringing in Automatic, they had a great run in Pro League so far in the online season. Number one, undoubtedly going to be about the finals, and they come to this event. And we weren't really sure what to expect, right? Obviously, they had a decent Northern Arena event, and they came to DreamHack Open, a proper test against some top European teams, the likes of like Virtus Pro, you know, and then coming in, they actually got to the grand final, and they looked like revitalized. This is the Cloud9 we haven't seen since, what, mid-2015, when that kind of era was about right?
Yeah, summer 2015.
July 2015, right? And that's when they're actually making consistent semifinals, grand finals. And this is probably the first time we've seen that since Sean left the lineup, I would say. This is probably the first kind of look back and towards time of actually a successful Cloud9 team. So what were your kind of standout points of seeing them play?
Well, I think my points, I've kind of emphasized, I think this is the first time they've had five players. Maybe the end of Sean Gare's era. You could even go back as far as the Hiko era, because Sean was always capable of the occasional game. But this is the first time they've had five players that can all explode at any time. Automatic is very good. We saw it with TSM at the end of the ECS time with TSM when he was there. He was great in that LAN environment. And we know Stewie has the potential. We know nothing's got potential. We know Shroud, et cetera. It's all there. Nothing. I think I already said that. You know what I mean. Skadoodle. That's the one I missed. Hmm. I think this is the first time they've had that. Now, the one thing I think they might lack is a little bit of tactical depth, but they're playing in a group and they're playing as a unit. And they think that I'm talking to Jordan. They have a foundation. They don't want to emphasize that too much, which does imply there might be a honeymoon period. But I'm more curious about your thoughts because you played against the old Cloud9. So now you can kind of see some differences as the analyst.
I think like Freakazoid in the old Cloud9 was like just such a motivating force, right? He was such a positive energy. And then when he was gone and they went into this new era that they're in now, they seemed like they were lost when they had Slammy and stuff. They seemed like they were trying to replicate what they had before, but now they got Stewie. I don't want to get on his dick too much, but that kid, you know, he's revolutionized the way that they're playing. Mm. And he's brought his style of aggressive run through smoke, don't give a fuck Counter-Strike, and he's kind of adapted that into the whole team. And they have players that can all do that stuff. And they're actually looking, you know, like they're playing smart decision-based Counter-Strike. Mm. In that final though, They look scared. Like
that was the problem, right?
Really scared.
That wasn't the same team we saw beat Envious in the semi-final. No. They looked really on point there. They were like confident with their abilities and actually willing to push and make the frags. Again, versus Pro, the first few rounds went against them. You could see that they were like clammed up, right? They just weren't doing the dynamic stuff we were seeing. They were going into like solid defaults and they were just weren't really trying to push for the pick themselves. They were allowing Virtus Pro just to take them down one by one. They looked so rigid. And we were casting. We always know CSGO finals have the potential to be fucking awful sometimes.
Yeah, there's a weird way about
and
that.
I thought this lineup, especially Virtus Pro versus Cloud9, VP, not really rattled at all. Those were playing their usual game. If they kind of step up and actually look like they're the team they've been throughout that tournament as well, I just didn't see Cloud9 actually stepping up and actually giving them a good game. And that's exactly what happened. The scoreline was a little bit flattering, I think. I think VP should have potentially won by even a bigger margin.
Yeah, I think that you kind of touched on something that's interesting as well with Freakazoid being that motivator, because in the final, we know Skadoodle doesn't talk a lot of times. If he's feeling it, he's on it. If he's not, he's dead silent. And Shroud's the same way. And there was a timeout call, I don't remember when it was in the game, and they zoomed in on Shroud on camera, and he was just sitting there.
Yeah.
Well, it was actually, I don't have a chair to lean back, but he was almost like dismissive, like not saying anything. He had his hands just rubbing his face, like, what's going on? And at that point, that's when maybe the Freakazoid can kind of get them going again. I think Stewie's done a good job of that, but he's still kind of inexperienced in that sense. And yeah, they broke down in the final. They definitely tensed up. And talking to Nothing afterwards, he was saying that it was like, you know, everything's great, everything's loose, we're doing good through the whole tournament. And then they get to the final, and it was like, we have to win a final.
Yeah.
We have to win a final.
He was the only one that was able to, you know, kind of sit back.
He was actually very good in the final still. Yeah. Like, he was actually playing well.
But he's the most experienced by far. So, you know, you give him that. He just needs to be able to teach his teammates how to absorb the pressure. I don't know. It's a hard thing to do. Beating the pressure is one of the most difficult things to do. It's just like, I just remember the train game, like letting Virtus Pro walk all the way at Ivy before even taking a fight. Like Skadoodle was back of the old bomb train with an AWP just waiting, and he missed so many sitters, like, because he was obviously nervous. And when you're sitting there, when you're holding one line and you're nervous, that's the worst thing, because you're so shaky, you know, your mind's drifting in and out. It's hard to stay focused because you other things start coming into your head. And there was two rounds there that I think if he had hit those shots, they probably would have won those rounds and potentially had a better chance in that game. But it was crazy how the way that Virtus kind of titled those maps and said it was like Christmas that they got those maps.
The thing is as well, Train, just looking at the previous results in the tournament as well, they played Flipside on Train, 16-4, battered them. Like, they looked so confident in that game. Same story versus FaZe as well, Train, 16-8. This side, FaZe are a decent Train side as well. We've seen that in Pro League. They definitely had to play that map in the addition of Ali. They looked great on it. Cloud9 just wrecked them. And then it was just like when they came up against Virtus Pro on that map, it just wasn't the same team. And I'm trying to work out whether it is, for me though, like in terms of the pressure, you're the underdog, right? You're the team that's not expected to be there. For me, that's just like, you got nothing to lose at that stage. Surely everyone's just going to be fired up. Let's just play our game and do what we can. What's the factor there? Like, is it like losing the pistol and then thinking, oh God, okay, this is it now. We're going to get wrecked by Virtus Pro. Is that the kind of mentality they're in? Like, how can you pinpoint what that is?
I think it boils down to the experience. Like you say, Nothing, it's weird to say, is the elder statesman now in that team. And I think the other guys are still young and inexperienced and everything's going well. But the one thing everyone wants is a champion. And it's kind of like the NIP run through Cluj, where they looked loose, and then all of a sudden they're like, whoa, wait a minute, we got a chance, and then they froze up too. It happens, and unfortunately, it shouldn't happen, but it does. And again, I think experience is a big part of it. I hope next time they reach a final, they learn from this, and they say, guys, we can't do that again. We got to stay loose and stay relaxed.
Yeah.
And that's almost where you kind of look at it. They had, I hope I say his name right, Danan, it's D-A-N... I-N or A-N,
the
anyway.
The guy behind them?
Yeah, he's part of the Cloud9 organization, has been for a long period of time. But he's always been involved with all of their teams in a managerial aspect.
Okay.
And he dealt mostly with, I think, their League of Legends team. But when Stunna left, he's kind of guy that comes in. Stunna might have just been a manager, but he'd been with that team for almost 2 years.
He was definitely part of the unit. Everyone knew
exactly.
He was
very good at understanding the personalities and roles. And this is where, you know, we talk about psychology. Well, you may not have a psychologist behind you in those moments, but Stunna was at least good enough to say, guys, what the hell is this? Whereas I don't think he knew them well enough to really step up. But it could benefit from someone else behind them. Again, I think that is more part of the unit.
Wasn't Slemmy's supposed to become the coach, though? Was that not the idea behind it? Originally,
and then at the same time that happened was when the new coaching rule came in. They say this didn't influence it. I don't know that whether or not it did, but they say it didn't. He wanted to play still.
Okay.
So that was kind of what everyone was anticipating and would make the most sense, but then he was decided he wanted to go play.
It's fair enough. He's still a very young lad, isn't he? So he obviously wants to find another team. There's lots of opportunities in NA still. Like, if you're in a...
Yeah, milk that NA.
If you're in a semi-good NA team, you're going to make some good leagues and make some money out of it. So it's still a chance for him.
What's wrong with the Australian cash cow?
We don't have a cash cow.
I'll come down and be your cash cow.
Thank you.
But you better milk me all the time.
He's got a lot of milk. And it's salty as hell.
Salty milk.
Yep. Anyway, I think that rounds up Cloud9 pretty nicely. Moving back onto VP, the guys actually won the event after having a complete shocker at Star Ladder, which we did our last podcast from. They looked completely shit there. Like, this is like the VP we're used to seeing, like, kind of in that slump period, right? After winning E-League, they come to the next event and they just back out in 2-0. Like, they come off the two best of ones, lose to an Asian team, which we'll go into later. And then just completely checking out the event. They looked horrible there. 2 weeks later, they come to DreamHack Open and they win the whole thing. This is the problem with VP right now. You never know what's going to turn up. It's such a boring conversation to have on the analyst desk because you really ask these guys for predictions. It's just like, oh, so VP going to win this game, right? And it's just like, well, if VP show up today, then yeah, sure. And it's like, it's so, it seems like such a cop-out when you say that thing on the desk, but that's the reality really, right? These two results, a disparity between them, Star Ladder and this event. They win this event, they go out in the groups in that one, and they've just won E-League. Like, what? How do you like connect the dots between those results?
I think that this year does suck to be an analyst.
Yeah.
In the previous years, there was four or five teams that were clear cuts above the rest, VP being one. And even if they had an inconsistent or off day, they still had enough experience as a team to work together and beat their opposition. You know, you might have had that one or two upsets where, versus a Dignitas or a 16-14 win. We're now in a position where there's multiple full-time teams, and if one of those top four teams slacks off, everyone's right there to nip at them. And they just can't get away with it anymore, so it's very hard to predict. And I don't know. I mean, even when they came back this week from that win, they go back into an online. They're all gone this time.
That's all right.
We go back into. Yeah, that's fine. It's part of the effect, guys. They come back from winning, and I think they just kind of say, hey, it's just an online match. I think their mentality is not. Like, we saw them go from, what was it, 13-3, 12-3 half, win pistol, and lose 16-14 on cobblestone.
Hellraisers, yeah. That was after Bucharest as well.
So I think that epitomizes
it. Where do these results come from? Like, you come back, you win E-League, and then you're shit. And then you come back, you win DreamHack, and then you come back to online, and you're losing the Hellraiser 16-14 after 12 and a half. Like, how are you supposed to predict what this team's going to do? Like, Chad, as a new analyst, how are you finding this kind of, this mentality with them? How do you describe it when you're asked this question?
Like, you need to know the inner workings of the team, right? You need to know how they go into it, and there's no way to know that.
Do you know how I know you're a new analyst?
How?
Where's your cable right now?
I don't give a fuck.
No, he said before.
Oh, okay,
all
right, all right.
I'm an edgy motherfucker.
Trendsetter.
Anyway.
Carry on. I thought you were going to just strangle me with it.
No. I think, you know, there's so much stuff that goes on within a team that we have absolutely no idea about, right?
Yep.
Like, there could be something going on in their lives outside of the game that affects one player, which then everybody in the team. Once you've been in a team with guys for, how long have these guys been together? Three years.
3 years.
Okay.
Yeah, 3 years and a month.
I could tell with my teammates if something had pissed them off, and it wasn't even gaming related, right? If it was just, I don't know, something bad at home, you know, they'd heard maybe one of their pets had died or, you know.
Oh, dude, if Jaden died, I'd be a wreck.
They got an argument with their girlfriend or some shit or something like that, right? You could tell. They didn't tell you. You could just see it on their face or the way that they were communicating. And anything like that in your life that, you know, slightly puts you off. And we know Virtus was saying that they had issues for that Kiev event, getting there or something happened beforehand or whatever.
A media day, I think they had, was
that's
it?
That's all it takes, right? Yeah. To tilt you away from focus, and you don't give a fuck. Because, like, let's be honest, they play that many events now. The oversaturation of the scene is nuts. It's like, okay, well, we don't win this event. Well, hold up. There's another event in 2 weeks' time with, you know, the prize money, that's okay, it's not as good. But it was still a big event, and it's still a chance for them to go and win and prove themselves. So, you know, people jump to conclusions, and they're like, oh, they're shit, or, you know, they're not playing well at the moment and stuff. But these teams, like you're saying, they're so much closer now. I just brought up the Pro League standings, right? I know it's online Counter-Strike.
Yep.
But
it does highlight it, though.
You can't really pick a team right now who you think is a standout. Sure, look, we had Fnatic previously, you know, but not anymore. Like, Godsent, you expected them to come in.
Right now.
I know they're not. I know Godsent aren't in Pro League, but they're also not looking fantastic in the whole scene. We'd say, what, Na'Vi are looking the best at the moment in the European side of things?
Well, they came to Star Ladder and dropped out in the groups as well. So it's difficult to even say that. They're an online play, they look great, right? That's fine. But still, that event when they came to it is when it was the first showing of Simple, right? He was still in the Zeus role. So I think obviously they're going to be a slow burner getting into it. But yeah, online, their form looks very good.
Yeah.
But still not a runaway. And there's no clear-cut winner apart from SK right now, but still with the whole
firm. Even with SK,
they just lost to Immortals yesterday, their counterparts.
Online Counter-Strike, you like.
Yeah, online Counter-Strike fans around the world.
I'm curious to see what happens with SK even when we get to New York.
Yeah, me
which
too.
We'll talk about a little bit later on, just because is there enough time to pick up the pieces that were dropped when they made those changes?
I think they're still going to do well. I just don't think they're going to live up to the hype that everybody's expecting. I think, like, I know we're not talking about that event right now, but I've got it here.
We're going to get there eventually.
Where is it? Out of all the teams going, it's going to be, like, besides Liquid, who have dropped off the face of the fucking planet.
Yeah. Yeah, that's weird.
They're gone. They're in the bin. That event is going to be ridiculously close. Like, I think these teams here are like the VP.
Yeah, you're right. I can't even tell
G2,
you like who's the clear cup favorite.
There isn't one. And
yeah.
The only one that's exciting.
I think this is one of those ones. We should do this later.
Yeah,
we are going to get there. But yeah. I think this is one of the ones where you have to predict from the bottom up. It's the best of the worst, basically. With yeah. the
start at the bottom, say who's going to come last,
exactly.
and then we'll move on. Okay, we'll do that later. Then that can be a fun game for everyone at home to do it with.
I normally would wait to the intermission, but I was running around doing visa issues and stuff. Right. I can't wait to go to the bathroom any longer.
We can't get off, guys.
You guys do envious, and I'll be right back. I'm sorry.
It's okay. Right then, Chad. So, now let's get into it. The real show begins from here.
Alrighty.
It's not even a bit. He has his fuck boy. It's not. Yeah, the fuckboy's gone. He's not even the only fuckboy in our group. Actually, we've got a couple. But envious, then. I've got in my notes, still showing signs of life since improving from the slump. A gradual return to form. I would say gradual is probably the operative word there. Like, obviously, they were in the fucking bin as well since Cluj. Like, every event dropping out of the groups, occasionally making the top eight, like very occasionally, and then still just dropping off to like a team completely that should be beneath them, right? And it seems like they're kind of stabilizing now. The adjustment of roles is they're not kind of changing the lineup at all. They want to stay with the same five they got. They're just adjusting the recipe, essentially, right? And it's like, it's not like they're increasing like this. It's like that sort of degree of recovery,
The
right?
problem is we have such a high expectation for this team, right? Mm. Whoa, fucking little fucking voice croak there.
You right?
Sorry, I'm an 18-year-old. 18? Surely I've gone through puberty by then. Anyway, I apologize for that. That's a stezza, we call that in Australia.
A stezza?
Yeah.
Is he a person?
I don't know why we call it that.
Okay.
Anyway, their rise is, gradual, like you're saying, but it's because we expect one of the top three teams in the world, right? That's what I think anyway. But I like the way Happy's been playing. Devil's been playing. I think if Happy can continue to be an aggressive lurker, Happy will sit there and just look at us and go, these guys are fucking retards. They don't know what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. But when you look back at Counter-Strike objectively and you go, we have a lot more information, right? And we base our analysis off of statistics and off of what we can see, and we can see everything. So it's not always fair. You need to know that lots of shit's happening that they'd have no idea about.
Yep.
But when you see somebody last alive, and if he'd just gone a little bit more aggressive, he could have potentially helped his team secure a round. And he's not doing it over and over again. It's very frustrating, but he's changed that style, and here we go. Fucking
fuck boy's back.
He's back.
Here he is.
Sire's down there for a minute.
That was a quick slash.
I forced it out.
Is this chair the squeaky one?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, that's the squeaky one.
That's the machine one.
Sorry about that. Back teeth are floating.
The thing is with Happy's place, right? Like, the thing is, the style hasn't changed too much. He's just changed. He's kind of tweaked it slightly, right? Like, he's actually a little bit more proactive in the lurking role. Like, he can actually be the one actually getting into positions where his teammates aren't. He's actually starting off the aggression by himself. He's not waiting to the last person to go in every single time. He's changing it up quite nicely. Like, he's actually on cash, especially, is what I like to watch him the most. Like, he can actually work out when there's no mid presence there whatsoever, be waiting for the rotations, and that lurk work makes complete sense, right? That's a part of the map his teammate don't need to worry about at all. And it looks great because on cash, especially, he seems to have worked out the timings absolutely perfectly right now. And we're talking about Happy, if you didn't realize.
In case
you
did. I figured that out.
We kind of just realized he's kind of changed from just going from like the full on lurk that's like kind of coming at the end, sometimes looking okay when he's getting the timings. Okay, but now he's actually kind of worked himself into a sort of play style that's actually really beneficial for the team. And when they're all playing really well and they're finding picks across the map, he can actually really come into his own. He looks incredibly intelligent right now. He's like quite on point with his timings and actually getting his team into positions where actually beneficial instead of being detrimental. Like, everyone's dead on the A side. If they had one more player, they might have won the gunfight. That's what it looked like before, at least.
We didn't swap. I thought we swapped somehow. I was going to say that. Okay, it's fine. Sorry.
Imagine this is a strategy, right? Yeah. You know Happy is always going to be, like, literally always on his own. I saw a strat that they ran on Mirage.
He's in
Happy
Palace.
Happy was in Palace.
Yep.
The rest of the team was in mid. Happy called for his teammates to come back to A. They were going to hit A. He ran from Palace to mid so he could lurk, even though he already had two teammates in mid.
Yeah.
Why not leave one of them there and he could stay where he was?
Yeah, especially when you have Devil who's capable of that too. They could leave Devil.
Here's an idea, right? Just hear me out for 1 second, Envy fans.
Okay.
Envy fans be like...
Okay.
Sorry, I said no private jokes when I'm doing this. Okay, we'll keep going.
So Happy is doing his more aggressive style solo play somewhere, right?
Yep.
Whether he dies or gets a kill, doesn't matter. You have three people. Let's just say Kenny, Apex, and MBK. Just chilling. They're not doing anything. Just sitting back. Devil's over somewhere feigning a default, throwing some nades, shooting some bullets, pretending like shit's going on across the map. Next minute... Fucking Happy's dead or gets a kill. Three other cunts are right behind him. Surprise, motherfuckers, we're in the bomb site. How unusual would that be?
Because
they wouldn't
expect
it. Because
they'd be like, oh, there's the Happy lurk.
Exactly. And then they're already cheating the rotate over, even if they kill Happy, because they're like, well, it's not this bomb site. You don't see that at all. Like,
It's a good point.
It's not a hard thing to
clever.
Do.
That is quite an interesting concept. Maybe you should become the envious coach.
Maybe you should just be an in-game leader, Chad.
Yeah, maybe.
I like that idea.
I'm going to see it one time ever.
I'm going to write that down.
Parlez-vous français? Oui.
Oui? Okay, yeah. Envious coach, done.
Yeah, I'll write that down. I'll send an email.
Cool.
See you happy.
Let the people, yeah. Done. All right, sweet.
It's on the memo.
But yeah, I think we covered envy. I don't really want to dwell on them.
No, okay. The headline is, though, been shit for the last 6 months.
Slowly
getting better and better, which is fine. I think they all admit that. They've been shocking. They've played the former world champions, definitely down the slumps, and they're coming out of it. Slowly but surely, they're making semifinals now. They're looking better and better. They lost 2-1 to Cloud9, but I still think this positive, the change of roles and the way Happy's playing right now. Kenny S in sensational form in some games at the moment, hitting some nut shots. You remember that game?
G2.
Like, that was absolutely balmy watching that. So
It was what?
Balmy.
The balmy army.
Why are you so short now? Where's the thing to do that? Is that what you did?
Mm-hmm.
Ah, cool.
Yeah, the Barmy Army. What does it mean?
Is that an Australian term or is that a...
It's a British term.
Yeah,
it just means like crazy, nuts. Like the English football team is known as the Barmy Army now.
Now we're like a podium and I'm Fernando Alonso and you can be...
We're not staying on topic at all. Henry's getting pissed off.
So we get back on track.
This is Henry after he copped a couple of chucky bars to the face. A
couple of bars. That was my face, to be fair. I was really pissed off that night.
I didn't even know you got hit.
I was like, everyone kept going to me, why are you so upset tonight? I was like, well, yeah, you'd probably be upset as well. The one thing you came here to do was cars and you got fucking ruined by some asshole in the crowd.
I liked your line that you said on Skype. Jokes on them, I love chocolate.
Just to gobble them up. No. Yeah, that was weird. We've covered that anyway.
All right, I'm sorry. I am
envious,
distracting us.
Yes, they're looking better and I think I like them as a team overall. I think it's a nice little package. Apex is starting to come back to life as well. He looks like he's actually going to be stepping up this year, and hopefully we'll see some great performances from him going forward. Anyway, let's move on to the MVP of the tournament, Neo. What a fucking masterclass that was from him.
Yeah,
the entire tournament as well. Like, he was obviously one of the most legendary names in the 1.6 era. Coming into CS:GO, still very good, but certainly not like contending for the top player in terms of like skill.
No.
Still very intelligent in terms of clutches. He's a very good fundamental CS player, but he was never considered like top 5 player in the world. Maybe not top 10, right? This tournament, he looks absolutely sensational. He's just pulling out all the stops. Every move he seems to be making is the correct one. Every clutch going in his favor, finding frags all over the place, filling every role, it seems, with MVP from event to event. He's just like, what a sensational time it's been for him recently.
Yeah, sick. And like you say, in CSGO, I was trying to think off the top of my head where he peaked at in the top 20 ratings over the last few years. But
it
doesn't really matter that much. The point is, like you say, he's never really been near the pinnacle of it. He's never been in that top position.
He was considered, like, in 1.6, he's probably one of the names considered the best Counter-Strike player of all time, right?
That's why him and Taz hooked up. They didn't like each other, but they realized that the Golden Five needed to be together to win, and it was a success. And that's kind of one of the things. They've stuck it out together as a team. We talked about this 3 years, 37 months now that they've been a team. That goes a long way, and they all still have these performances, and seeing him perform as he did, Taz has alluded to it, you know, old but gold.
Yep.
They still have it, and they're committed to it. They definitely look committed.
Yeah, I agree. They certainly look committed. Thoughts, Chad?
I think that team has the chance to have any player be the MVP. Right? Yep. Like, you look at it, any single one of them could be the MVP at any tournament because they all can perform well. And nobody is like, you know, you can go, oh, Pasha, sometimes he has shitty performances and stuff. But realistically, as the team works, when they are on fire, everybody's contributing. And just on
you can't say on fire on the show. We're Drop the Bomb.
Oh.
I'm just kidding.
Neo came 17th in the world rankings last year, right? In the top 20.
Keep going.
And Forrest came 16th, and both of those guys have got MVPs at events in 2016. So it's just, they're resilient. That's the buzzword, you know? But, like, the thing is, with these guys being teammates for such a long period of time, it's like a brothership's form, like breaking up the band kind of thing. You know, when I retired, my teammates didn't even wish me happy birthday. I was only a month afterwards.
What?
I was so sad. I was like, I spent a year with these guys. They didn't even wish me happy birthday.
Have you confronted them about this?
No.
Oh, this is the first exclusive.
Can we get a close?
So
can we get a close up by any chance?
No, my head.
Yeah. Oh. Okay. Confront them. Tell them right now. It's the one with the red light.
Fuck you, cunts.
You're joking. All stillmates. All stillmates, of course.
No, right now they're renegades in a tournament in Shanghai.
Yeah, they're probably not watching this, to be fair.
No, they're not.
I think you're fine.
Shanghai's pretty sick, though. I like. I need to that go
event,
to China.
From what I've seen, that event, there's them and a couple of MVP, and that's about it. There's 30 teams there, though.
How appropriate that the Asian teams are playing.
That's right. So it's like there's three names I've heard of.
I think there was Risky, the guys from the Middle East, but they lost to some noobs.
Right. Well, that's as much preview as that event probably requires, I would say. But we are doing an Asian special this event. We probably should have looked into that a bit.
Well, we still can. We've got an intermission coming up. We can take some time to dig into it a little bit.
We haven't even got past the first bit.
Okay.
To think that we need to cut this show down in duration is going to be impossible. My elbow looks so bad.
Okay, let's talk about FaZe then as a whole. FaZe, bringing Alu in, right, they look great in terms of Pro League. They were looking like they were gelling as a unit, and he was the perfect addition to the squad. A dynamic, aggressive AWPer who was confident in his own ability, kind of the opposite of what Fox was. Fox was a decent player, in my opinion. I think he got a bit too much flack. But Alu coming in, he seemed like that was the missing part of the puzzle from what we saw, right? Online, it looked amazing. That was the honeymoon period, which is another buzzword for you there, Chad.
Honeymoon period, I love that one.
Yeah, and it looked great. And then he got to the LAN, and it's the classic FaZe story. Win the opening game, then you lose the loser bracket game, then you're fucking gone. And they look quite quiet after
that. Can we talk about the honeymoon period thing?
Go on.
Isn't the honeymoon period is like when you actually enjoy the person you just got married to and you're having sex all the time?
That's why we didn't go on a honeymoon.
And then as soon as you've been with that person, you've been married about a year, then the sex starts dropping out of the equation.
Have you been married before?
Sorry?
Have you been married before?
No. I've been in a long-term relationship.
Are we equating sex to wins?
No, we're equating the first
success of any degree.
Okay, let's talk about like when the Envious was first brought into the CSGO team, right? And they kind of made that team, and they went to IEM, I can't remember, Gamescom one, and they just blew everyone out of the water with a very loose play style. Everyone was looking great. Everyone was fragging. It looked fantastic, right? And that was like the honeymoon period because it was a new play style, that 4-1 mentality, Happy doing his own thing, and the four other players going around the map and just blowing everyone up, and now that lot coming in, and no one knew how to play against it, right? They'd never seen it before. And that's the honeymoon period. You have two or three events where no one's worked it out, and then all of a sudden it starts gradually dropping off and they're not looking as successful. That's when people have had time to download the demos, watch it all back, then you have to kind of reassess your play style to everyone's kind of worked out what you're doing, and then you start getting a bit jaded by it all. The things you've changed aren't working, and for me that's like you have a couple of events where you look great as a new team, and then when people start paying notice to you, and then you kind of have to readjust, and that's the kind of honeymoon period dropping out. It's not as fun anymore. It's not seeing as easy.
The epitome of it, I think, is Cloud9 2015. When they brought in Freakazoid, they just started to get those wins. No one really, and everyone admitted it, that they'd never really prepared for Cloud9 because they didn't anticipate anything, and therefore, once they started counter-stratting them, that's when the success trailed off again.
The thing I think with FaZe is, if you can negate the players, like the individual skill, the way that they like to play positions, you're going to win because they don't look like they have a lot of depth. They rely heavily on individual players.
Absolutely.
And I think it's like a failed project in the sense of they throw a whole bunch of nationalities together. All of these players can be stars in their own team. You could literally build a team around Rain, AZ, Alu, maybe not Keo, maybe not Jacob, but those are guys who you consider like second frags in your team. But the other three, you know, they've been touted as the best players from their region at some point, you know, or their country. And they've kind of been thrown into this mix and it's not working. I don't know how you'd fix it. Like, I think maybe keep it completely Scandinavian. You know, Rain, Jacob, AZ, that's a good... Oh, Alu, that's Scandinavian as well.
Yeah.
Maybe. Yeah, I don't know. I think they need to reassess. They need maybe to potentially take a risk on a leader. I know that team was the one that was like, okay, we're not going to have...
Existence. Bring him back. Yeah. That would be the one, right?
Yeah.
You can do anything. You got Kiyoshima there as well.
Yeah.
A bit little mate for him. And
it'd be interesting to say the least.
You could bring in Zeus. He's an in-game leader.
Yeah, he wants to play still, though. He's one of those guys.
I know.
See, you got to be like me.
Yeah,
it's not worth it anymore.
I think
Put that one on the memo. We got two teams to reach out to for Chad to be a coach today.
What? Two teams to reach out to. Dot, dot, dot.
Nice.
Just in case I forget.
More dots than you said, but I like that. It's not a ellipsis anymore. It's a... Or ellipsis.
Is that to be continued?
Do I have the mic on the wrong side? I think I do.
It doesn't really matter for today.
I'm going to turn around.
I don't think they're directional.
These
ones aren't.
FaZe, do we see them in this current lineup? Do we see them ever making any sort of
done.
Real impact?
They're in the bin.
You think they're already considering the start they had on Pro League? You don't think they're just trailing a little bit? It's a little bit of a slump for
them? They need to reinvent the style. I watched them try and throw executes in and it didn't look like they knew why they were doing it. And that sounds really harsh, but it seems like somebody has to give direction to a team, right? There has to be a vibe or a pace set. You got two ways of addressing a match. You either go with your style and you just go, we're going to fucking do this, and if it doesn't work, then we'll adjust. Or, hey, we're going to go in, we know this is how they play, and we're going to play around that.
Yep.
You pick one of those two things. There's no middle ground. You don't go in going, hey, we're just going to feel out literally every single round as it goes by doing defaults. Because if you do that and you have no intent, everything falls apart so quickly because everybody's a playmaker at that point. It's like, well, I've been given the freedom and a default to do whatever I want. There's no restriction. There's no idea. There's no plan. And if there's no plan, you're just going to go ham and hope that it happens. And when it doesn't, you fall apart. Everybody just does one at a time. You got guys who are left in a 3v5 situation. You can't do anything. You need somebody who can go, all right, we're going to set the pace by doing this. This works well for us. Then we're going to fall back to this. And then once we've done, you want to have a game plan that you can actually work through. You want to kind of prep it beforehand. A thing that we used to do was plan the first four rounds regardless, okay? So pistol round, if you win, what antico are you running? What second antico are you running? What first gun round are you running? The best, like, let me, Cache is a good example. If we won pistol round on T-side Cache,
yep.
Then we'd have a B
Cache,
execute.
For those of you playing at home.
Yeah, we'd have a B execute that we'd do with lots of Molotovs, and I'd go and be the bait in middle and make people look at me, make sure they couldn't go vent. Then we did another one, and then if we held onto a lot of our SMGs for the first gun round, we'd do a full A execute with SMGs.
Sorry, you mean the Jaden round.
The Jaden round.
Okay. That's right.
So we'd do a full execute on A with the Jaden weaponry.
Right.
And always
get
the bomb down.
Here next time, by the way.
Let him finish his point. Sorry. Keep going.
And we had a plan, and we had that across most of our maps. And it doesn't seem like FaZe have a plan. I'm seeming very harsh on them right now, but I think they know that they don't have direction. And that's the one thing they're lacking, because they're all talented players.
They are.
I'm not saying anybody on that team is shit. I'm just saying the way that they address the game is.
That game, that team kind of started, though, like the individual players thing, it kind of started as like the outcasts.
Yeah.
It was Michael Lilly going to players who were
King Gwyn
thrown,
when it first started,
exactly,
right?
thrown out of other teams and were sitting in a pool.
It was a much different lineup back then. It was like Scream, Michael Lilly. Maybe Michael Lilly wasn't even in that one, was he?
No, it was Michael Lilly was the one that started it. It was him. Scream.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, Scream was the first one to be cut. It was Fox, Scream.
Michael
Lilly. Not Scream.
No, Scream was there.
Scream was there.
Scream was there to the very beginning?
Yeah.
I thought he was the one that came in for Scoyton.
No, he was. I'm pretty sure.
I don't remember.
I think he came in for Scoyton because he rang one game and went.
Can we just say
that they called
him motherfucker? I don't know. I don't like the way he sounded that guy's name.
Scoyton? Sky Kitten?
I'm so glad he doesn't play anymore because that was the most horrible thing trying to pronounce.
He's coming back, my friend. He's coming back.
Every cast is like, we're trying to pronounce
him. He's coming back
time.
On a different continent. You heard it here first.
Drop the bomb.
Isn't he playing? Well, that's not here first. We already knew that he was playing with XP3.
Yeah, you're right. Okay. They're going to a new org.
Reverse the bomb. It's not being dropped.
This guy bought a kit. Don't buy a kit. It's a waste of money.
Right. Just to finish this tournament off, we've been pretty in-depth with this so far, 45 minutes on it. Dignitas, they seem to be going strength to strength right now. They always start off in these tournaments pretty poor. They always get battered in the first round, it seems, but they always come back. They seem very good in best of threes. They can actually play very effectively in those ones. We saw a Star Ladder as well. They opened it up against Godsend. Well, got battered 16-3 in the first map. I think it was on Mirage.
Yeah.
And they came back and absolutely owned them in the best of three after that and knocked them out of the tournament. So,
well, I wouldn't say owned. It was a reasonably closely contested series, but they did look the better team.
Exactly,
sure.
Right. I mean, the point is, like, when you get owned like that in 16-3, that was a complete battle, right?
Yeah,
you come back and
beat
them 2-0. It's just like that's a pretty big message to send out, right? That readjustment. They seem to be much more effective in the best of threes when they've kind of calmed down. Maybe the initial event nerves kind of get shaken off after you lose that first game. You have to kind of adjust and reassess what's going on. But players like Config, for me, he looks incredible right now. Like, they look like they're going from strength to strength. And I think they want to be a top three team in the world. And every event, they're getting better and better. Maybe they can actually achieve that goal.
The cool thing right now with the Danish scene is, although the talent is diluted, similar to how Sweden is, they're not even, I don't think their goals are they all want to be top three. It's definitely in the cards, but it's not something they outwardly say, like, top three, that's it, that's all we want. Their goal is to be the best Danish team. And I think that's really cool because they're so close, it creates this grudge match, which creates this rivalry, which
step,
pushes
right?
them all forward. Exactly. And I think Astralis right now, I have to say, is the one losing that battle.
Yeah.
I think Heroic stepped
beyond
them.
I don't think they can be called the best team in Denmark.
No, I don't agree.
I think they're almost third.
I do agree.
You do agree, yeah.
I do agree. Not that I don't agree.
I think they're almost the third best team right now.
I think we should have a Danish derby sponsored by Space Jam, Fnatic Gear, Dark, and Twitch.
Yeah, you're gonna be on the show more often.
Yeah,
now.
Sweet.
Yeah, we're gonna have a Danish derby.
We're gonna up your pay. We're gonna double your pay from zero.
Send me a sick cap like Henry's got, and I'm done. I'm in.
This is quite a nice cap.
We've got. Oh, we don't have that exact one. We've got about 10 other ones.
This was a limited edition one. I'm the only one that has this
in the world.
I don't know. I just made that up.
I'll give you a Darken shirt. I got another one of these.
Yeah, I'll take one of them.
Glitch one. I've got. Yeah, I actually have one of these. I have another one of these sitting at the apartment.
But Dignitas.
Got a hoodie.
Are we doing a 3-hour Joe Rogan special?
No,
it feels like
we're
getting there. We're almost at an hour. We've only done the first topic so far. So we've got about six more topics to go, guys. So strap yourself in.
Point is, Dignitas, they're looking much better. And the one thing I want to say about them, Config, you mentioned it.
Yeah.
We had Kirby go through that team. Looked amazing when he was on them. Not looking great now. AZ looked absolutely incredible. Probably the best of all of them when he was on the end of the time there. In fact, arguably among like the Nico and Simple-esque when he was in the last few weeks with that team.
Yep.
He's kind of trailed off. Now they've got Config. There's something about that team that breeds individual
and
players.
Major Spoil as well. Another great pickup from SK Gaming.
Yep.
So that's that was the farming team it felt like for the Danish team. Like every time they got a decent line, they got anywhere, someone would get stolen, and then MSL would be left out. Well, let's do this again.
But like that farming team of Dignitas, yeah, they got fucked for a little while.
Yeah.
But then with Team X then becoming Heroic, it looked like they got absolutely fucking reamed. And then now they're awesome.
Yeah.
This new lineup, they're like,
I know, I
thank
them
fuck
off.
You took those guys from me, because now like Frizz and Muddy, they're like just fucking laughing.
Yeah.
Their team is much better than it was. And the way that team works, it's great to see they play a good brand of Counter-Strike.
I think it's interesting you bring that up with Heroic, because I think the same point for KGB going to Dignitas, because yeah, after sure. they got rid of Nico, Pimp said he wanted to op. He didn't do very well with it, let's be honest. So then he was removed. And suddenly you were left with roles that were conflicting. No one knew what they were doing. Kirby was doing great. Astralis steals him away. But guess what? They get an opper. And I think it's been beneficial to them as well. I think I it was agree. A trade that was potentially supposed to be better for both, although Astralis is struggling.
I think the farming days are over. We've got like solid three Danish teams now. Heroic, they said they've signed contracts now for a year with their own brand. No one's going to get poached. Dignitas, I think they're safe as well. Everyone's happy with the way the team's going. No one's going to be trying to steal them at any time. I'm sure Dignitas have now protected their players, made sure that's going to be the five going forward as well. Astralis, that's where the question mark is right now. And that's going to be kind of interesting. Obviously, they're having poor results time and time again. Obviously, the roles, the recipe of the team, that's always changing every single time. They had a boot camp before Starladder, never got going at that event, really. And then it just seems like there's just nothing going right for them right now. And what's the change? You just replace Carrigan and try and pick up someone like Glaive? I don't think he's going anywhere. Like I said, he just signed a contract with Heroic. So where do they even go with this right now? Do they have to change something or just keep adjusting the roles? How did they get out of their slump right now? But that's maybe a conversation for another time.
Yeah, that is a huge
That's
the deck
of cake. That's 20 minutes.
Yeah, I think that's personality conflict as much as play style right now.
Ooh.
So that's why that's we won't get into it.
To be continued.
Yeah, that's a big conversation, I think.
That's a pre-bomb.
I think we need Fuckboy Alex Richardson to go over that one.
Yeah, we might need the Fuckboy.
Where is the Fuckboy?
He's out fucking like a Fuckboy. So that's what they do.
If you're watching, hello, Alex.
As you're getting your massage right now, birthday massage. Yeah, I know your eyes are, you know, upper body. You can easily hold a tablet right now. She's not massaging up there, so.
Anyway,
should we take an intermission? Should we take an intermission now and come back in? We'll talk over the groups for E-League, Pro League, ESL New York quickly, and then.
Quickly, I'm in no rush. I got nothing to fucking do today, boys. I know that you guys want to make this quick, but.
We don't have to.
Let's send
Tom
out.
Do you
want
to do the E-League groups first? I was going to try and just combine all the sort of the groups, because we talked about the teams.
We can take the intermission. What are we doing during the intermission?
Like,
what
are we actually doing? Hates the intermission.
I don't understand it.
He does hate
we
the intermission.
We gotta do some things.
Yeah, but these people could be watching on their fucking telephones. They can whatever they need to do, they can just take it with them. What do you need to do?
I already went to the bathroom.
Yeah, you're sweet.
Yeah.
Are we skipping
going.
Intermission?
Let's keep going.
Don't we have to run? Wait. We actually can do this today.
Hi, producer. Do we need to run any ads during the intermission?
We do need to run ads halfway through at some point. Let's do one more topic, and then we'll come back into the meat and potatoes, the documentary we've got coming up.
I love meat and potatoes.
We've got a documentary, probably the best one we've ever made. Tom has been working like
you're a potato,
there's
Chad.
No tomorrow. He's done a fantastic job. We've got like a feature length. Can we listen, please?
I'm excited about this.
We've got a feature length Asian CSGO thing, one of the most interesting topics in CSGO right now. Where have they come from? Where are they going? And what's the future hold for them? So that's going to be a really cool documentary we've got coming up. The best we've made. We're going to come to that after the intermission. That's when we'll take a break.
It
and
is
build
the best we've made. I watched that and I was enjoying it.
We've interviewed all the top teams, the coaches, and we've kind of done amazing footage. We've got stories from personalities in the scene. It's such a really nice package.
Features the original gangster of esports.
Who's that?
Ken Yang.
That's right. He's our alcoholic spirit animal. That's what I refer to him as. Yeah. It's
right.
True.
Without further ado, then, E-League groups have come out. Chad, a league you've been part of.
Oh, we're going. We're still going.
We're still going, okay. A league you've been part of in the past. Would you agree that the format for E-League was a little bit confusing at times in the first season? That would seem to be a feedback that some of the guys, or some of the viewers were giving. It was quite difficult to keep track of. As a whole, or do you?
No, I was fine with it. I think it's because it was a weekly thing and it was spread out that people were kind of lost. But, and also because the broadcast was on Twitch and then sometimes you couldn't watch all the production.
Yeah.
The production, it was because it was the TV show and shit on the Friday, right? So people might have found that confusing. From the inside, being a player in it, I didn't find it confusing at all.
I thought it was okay. I thought as a CSGO product, I thought it was a really, really nice way to put it all together. It looked like a very clean, polished, ready for TV product. I think it was just some slight adjustments made. And I'm really looking forward to see what they bring to season 2. And we have got the groups to look at as well. So We don't. We can't really bring them up on screen. That would have been something good to have done.
We were good at that. We were good at that at the start of the year. We actually had stuff like that, but we've been busy as a motherfucker.
Okay.
Busy as a beaver, as they say in Canada.
We had that on screen. It'd be so much easier to represent what's going on.
I'm going to put the link in Twitch chat, and you can all go there if you need to see them.
I like that.
Work on YouTube, but...
What?
Not as effective.
It's fine. Fuck.
We'll put it in post-production. We'll
all right, look, I'm going to list them off for those of you listening.
Group A.
And who are not even watching on YouTube, that might be doing the podcast via SoundCloud. Group A, Mouse Sports, Cloud 9, FaZe, Immortals. We've got two Europeans, two
probably the
Americans,
least stats group,
not
I would
North
say.
And South. Well, we'll see. I think that's it's a fairly level group, I would say. It's not stacked, but it's level.
Yeah,
that
but
I can
like,
see
in terms of like,
of
it's
four.
Supposed to be like a seeded thing, right?
But all right, let me list the groups first, and then we'll do that.
Yeah, go on.
Group B.
Make it full screen, and then we can show it.
Oh, yeah, you can put it on here. You can put it on my
feed. Oh,
he goes
right.
to my thing here. Hold on.
I like having full production.
Don't do it yet.
Group B, I'm still going to list them.
Yeah.
Virtus Pro, NIP, G2, Echo Fox. Group C, Na'Vi, Navis Vincera, as you... told us the story.
The blue guys.
Astralis, Alternate Attacks. This one's an interesting one for me in a lot of ways. You've covered it up. Alternate Attacks, now you can bring it up. Fnatic, Envious, Dignitas, Optic, that's group D. And SK was the other one in group C, I forgot.
Yes, nice.
There it is. Nice! So wow. There you go. So group A, now that we aren't on the screen, that's going to be so much better.
Should I zoom in some more?
Yeah, why not?
There you go.
That's too much.
Henry, there we go. That'll do.
All right. So group A, as you were saying, it might be the least stacked group, and I think that just means the least top-heavy group, in my opinion, because I think, honestly, although we just talked about FaZe being shit right now and struggling, Mouse Sports with Oscar, they just had a boot camp. They're looking better. FaZe, there's the potential. It's there. And on the right day, they could explode. I think anyone in that group could go through.
I think, in terms of like level playing field, I absolutely agree. I would say, let's just reiterate, two teams go from each group, right?
Yep.
So Mouse Sports, Cloud 9, FaZe, Immortals. Immortals, after beating SK yesterday as well, and the addition of Zeus, I'm not so sure. Like, I wasn't expecting too much from that pickup as well. But they're beating teams like SK. That's kind of impressive, right? Obviously, it's an online game, but still, that kind of sends a little bit of a message out. They just won Northern Arena as well. You know, this is looking pretty positive for them. They're definitely a hot contender. Mouse Sports, with the addition of Oscar as well. Cloud 9 in the form they're in. I would say FaZe. You're absolutely right. With this kind of field, they probably could have a decent showing against these sort of players and kind of similar play styles as well. For Cloud9, quite a loose play style compared to with FaZe as well. But in terms of the top two, if I had to give you a prediction, I would say it's going to be... Oh, do I go with Cloud9 or Mouse Sports? I'm going to go Mouse Sports Immortals.
I think that's the weird thing. Mouse
Sports Cloud9.
I want to believe,
but I feel like Nico and Oscar.
And I don't think Immortals is touchable right now, oddly enough. I think they're playing excellent fundamental Counter-Strike. Mm. Even though Cloud9's leading the way right now in North American Pro League, I think Immortals are playing very well. So I think it's Immortals out, Cloud9, Mouse Sports, that's the toss-up.
Chad?
I'm going to go the opposite to both of you.
You're going
to
say FaZe Cloud9?
Nah, FaZe are in the bin, but I think Cloud9, Mouse... I think Immortals, you know, they're a good team and stuff, and they've had a decent performances recently, but I got a feeling that the Cloud9 team is still going up. You know, I know that they struggled in Northern Arena and they weren't able to take Immortals out there, but I think that was not because, like, I think both those teams are pretty evenly matched, but I think Cloud9 played under their level at that. And Mouse Sports, I've been impressed. Fuck Mouse Sports off. Let's go Cloud9 and Immortals, actually.
Right, well, there it is. That's Group A decided. Group B, Virtus Pro and the Ninjas in Pajama. Pajamas. Gamers 2 and Echo Fox. I think it goes without saying they're not going to have much impact in that group. Chad, would you agree? Surely not going to be able to step up to the likes of these titans of Counter-Strike.
I think they're stuffed.
Yeah. I think that's fair. Matt, obviously, they have some interesting results online, but in terms of the LAN against that kind of lineup, if they were in Group A with those kind of guys...
Yeah, I might give them a chance. Now, Echo Fox, to me, if I look at everybody in the entire league right now, I don't think any group would be easy for them. No offense. I think Optic might be down there with them.
A group of Optic, Alternate Attacks, Echo Fox, and FaZe, they might have a chance.
They might have a chance. That'd be right. Alternate Attacks, don't rule them out, by the way. They're sneaky little buggers.
I'm ruling them out.
All right, fair enough.
But see, like, Virtus Pro, NIP, and G2.
Case closed.
Yeah, VP, NIP, and G2, right? You'd consider those guys in
that's
the top...
That's the fucking group of death, man.
Top six in the world, those three teams. They'd fit somewhere in the top six. Like,
what is with G2, by the way? Cologne. They're in the best form they've ever been in. They get fucked in the groups there, too. They had Fnatic and SK in their group.
You don't want to make it into the playoffs of a major man. It's not important. Don't worry about that.
You're right. Okay, I'm sorry.
They play for the small tourneys. No, yeah. I don't know. They just must have jitters. Who cares? They're on there. they've shown good form. I think the NIP thing's interesting to me. I think we might see something interesting with Pitt and McAlealy happening. Maybe let's keep both of them.
You can't do what? You're going to have a six-man lineup?
Let's do it. Let's fucking do it.
That old thing? Out.
Why not?
I have an idea.
I can give you reasons why.
I have an idea. I've got a really good idea, guy. Well, I've actually theorized about this, because this is something we used to do in COD, like at the very, when we were fucking pugging and stuff. If someone was really good on one map, you take the sixth man, and you're like, oh, you're good on Crash, you're shit on Crash, okay, you're out, you're in.
The problem is with the mages, Volvo don't allow that.
Yeah, exactly. And it is a theory that could come to work. If you have one guy who's really good at a role on, like, Nuke, and you're a shit Nuke team, you bring in that one guy, and you can kind of play around, like Mike Lilly on Overpass for what Nip did. Not saying it's the ideal. I'm just saying it's a theory that people have talked about.
What
I want to say is that Virtus Pro, remember, the defending champions in this group, and we're inconsistencies, but that's such a hard group to call,
isn't
it?
Big league players, the VP guys, they show up.
I was going to say for Pitt, they could just consign him to LGB for 6 months like they did with Michael Lilly, and it'd be fine.
Anyway, predictions, boys. Out of those three,
that's a fucking hard group.
Who's the one going out, basically, I need to know.
Echo Fox is out.
Yeah, we know that. So I said out of the top three on the screen right now, who's going out apart from who your top three?
That's any given Sunday.
Yeah, I agree with that sentiment.
I would speculate. Oh, I don't know. It's really hard, isn't it? This is impossible. Virtus Pro, that's another fucking classic case of, oh, do they show up? I don't know. Could be interesting if they do. What if they don't?
I'll put my Stagutz on the line.
I'd say Virtus Pro, because they're current champions this league. You have to say they're going to go through. They're going to be okay here. Between NIP and G2, both can beat each other. I feel like G2 have more firepower as a whole. They're performing on the day. But NIP, amazingly good at the moment
and
in terms of like big
G2,
pressure situations. Yeah,
smoke G2 and Kiev in the final.
Yeah,
I would say
Pro NIP would be my gut feeling right now. But
poor G2, man. Honestly, it doesn't matter how good they're doing; they always get put in a shit group.
Yeah,
it's I'm gonna say Virtus. I'm not even gonna predict, man. This is shit. I want to say NIP G2 go through. Some thunder lightning is gonna strike and Virtus Pro is gonna go out. That's just me just making a bold prediction. That's not even logical.
If it's NIP with McAlealy, then they'll go through.
Yeah, you think he's actually brought something to the table here?
They look better.
Yeah,
they look spicier.
Do.
Yeah.
You know,
but is this the honeymoon period, yeah, as you would
and
say?
As Yanko pointed out as well in a response during his AMA, is McAlealy playing with no pressure because he's a stand-in? Once they implement him into the team, is that suddenly too structured, too rigid, and then they have problems?
Possibly, but... I'm assuming they're waiting for Pitt's hand to get better, right?
Assuming. Should never do that.
Sorry. Make an ass of it. Yeah.
Yep.
I think, let's say, I'm going to go with VP G2, but if McAlealy's playing, then I'm going to go with VP Nip.
Fair enough. I would say the same. I would say like G2 definitely can even win the group. Like, who knows? But still, let's move on. Like you said, we're going for a Joe Rogan special. Group C. This
sounds like a bad thing.
Yeah, well,
he's pretty good at podcasts.
He is. He is the master, but I'm not sure our demographic really wants 3 hours of us talking.
Well, usually they don't want more than 10 minutes of me talking. Yeah. So,
well, Group C, another very stacked group here, I'd say. And you can see not as sincere, Astralis, Alternate Attacks, the kind of bogey team in this tournament. Like, where the hell did they come from? Not our godsend. Denied them entry.
Yeah.
And then SK. So, obviously, I'd say it's fair to say Alternate Attacks are going to make a dent. They've had some interesting results online, I think, getting towards a LAN environment against the likes of SK Gaming, Astralis, you know. They have got some interesting players there. Players you haven't really heard of for a long time. Like, they've been knocking around in CSGO. They've attended like lots of major qualifiers and all that sort of stuff. But
can I ask what the like Ian thing is? Like Tarsin, Tabsin, Tizian. Is that a thing in Germany? Or is that just like a common suffix for?
Well, Tizian's his actual name.
That's a good point. Wow. You're right. I can hear production laughing. I don't need first names anymore, man. I don't even have one. I'm just Sadokiss. It's how my parents refer to me now.
Do they really?
Sometimes.
They go, hello, young Sadokist, how's it going? This is our son, Sadokist. To be fair, that would be kind of weird. Anyway, let's just get back on track. I'd say the clear front runners have to be Na'Vi and SK, right?
100%.
Yeah, that's clean cut. Like Astralis have potential to have some good games, but I don't think they'll pick up any maps against those two right now. I think that Na'Vi will be overwhelming. SK will be back on form at that point.
Na'Vi, SK out of the group. Two best teams in the world in one group.
Yeah, absolutely. Astralis, they beat Na'Vi and Starladder, right? And that was like an amazing result. But still, that was the weaker Na'Vi. We know they're readdressing the issues they've got. We did an interview with StarX, actually. I think we'll release that next week. But we've got some interesting answers from here.
I don't know if we'll release that next week.
Well, we've got it on the back burner, right? right?
Yeah, we've got one more person that we've got to add to that.
All right, well, if we find a time to do it, when we do a season two, but we've got a really cool interview with him. We've got some interesting answers about that team in the future holds. That's why I kind of want to get out while it's piping hot, you know? But anyway, yeah, I think that group's kind of clean cut. Na'Vi and SK, Astralis and attacks, that could be kind of interesting attacks. You never really know. It's one of the teams you're not going to bother watching the demos of, right? You're just going to turn up and say, yeah, get me to it. I think that's fair, isn't it? Would you waste time playing against them?
Well, he played for Renegade, so they had to pick up wins where they could, so he'd watch them.
Like, they're going to be surprised by it. You're not going to watch all their maps on demos and stuff, are you?
No, you're not. You're going to write them off, and rightfully so.
So why did you laugh then?
Because it's funny that we're just saying you guys are shit. You shouldn't even be in the tournament. Why did you take Godsend's place, you piece of shit?
They've done a great job there.
Fuck you, alternate attacks, # Henry G.
You took a lot out of that statement, didn't you?
Well, I'm just...
you got a lot out of that.
He reads between the lines, mate. Yeah.
That's what you're implying. I'm going up.
Okay, fair enough. Well,
welcome back.
So yeah, that's an easy group.
Astralis is
Na'Vi SK.
I think I agree. But Astralis is kind of the weird one where if they finally get their shit together, they could contest in it. We've got a little bit of time before that starts, but not a lot, to be fair.
Group D, Fnatic, Envious, Dignitas, and Matt's favorite team, Optic.
Only because they have a cool flag.
That is the closest group.
Yep.
What do you think about Fnatic right now?
I think Fnatic's safe.
They're an unknown entity, really. Like, they've only played online Counter-Strike, right? ESL New York, which is our next topic, I believe, it will be the first LAN event they'll have played. So let's see how they go there, because Lecro, he hasn't played a lot of events in his time. Someone was telling me he was working... Were you guys just talking about Lecro? I kind of zoned out.
Yeah, we did an interview with him.
Yeah, you're saying something about the grocery store or something? I don't want to go too much into it.
Before he got picked up by Godsend, he was working in a grocery store. Yeah. He's playing an FPL, like a decent CS player.
You can watch it, actually, if you go to our YouTube.
Yeah, it's a really good documentary. Go check that out. It's the story of Lecro on our YouTube channel. He was working in a grocery store. He had no kind of ambition as to what he was doing, like finished school a couple of years before that. He's not a super young guy. He's not like 18 or anything.
He's like 24 or something.
23, 24, I think. Yeah, like most people would assume he's like just broken out. He's like kind of like super young talent. He's actually reasonably old considering Counter-Strike levels, right? Like if you look at some of the teams.
We must be ancient then.
Yeah, like I'm almost 29, right? So I'm definitely well past my sailor date.
It's fucked up how old I am already.
So he was like one of the guys who kind of came out of nowhere and joins Godsend, and then Fnatic, one of the most prestigious gaming orgs in the world. Now it's his full-time job. It's a really cool story. But Fnatic, for me, it's more of like that's going to be a slow burner, I guess. Like they've got Olaf Meister and Denos, obviously, that kind of wheeled them all together, but it's going to take time. That's not an overnight success story. That's not going to be one of those ones that's going to be, this is the new era of Swedish CS. This is going to take a few events. They're going to have some horrible results. They're going to have some ups and downs.
Do we know if they're running the new coaching world at E-League?
I would assume so.
There's been no official statement on that.
I don't know, but I would assume so.
Yeah, like they want to have Valve in their back pocket.
I think Star Ladder was one of the last events we had the actual coaches there.
Well, ECS said that they don't plan on doing that.
Okay, true. So you guys probably already had a discussion about this coaching rule, and I know that we have topics to talk about.
Yeah, we've had a massive one with Yanko on the show.
Okay, well, I won't give my opinion.
I'll give you...
30 seconds.
No, I'll give you 45.
I don't give a fuck.
Go on.
I don't think that the coaching rule is as bad as what everyone's making it out to seem.
I agree.
The coach can still prep a team. If, you know, you looked at, say, League of Legends as an example, the coach can do a lot of work there. The same thing can be applied to Counter-Strike. The coach gets 4 pauses that he can talk in. The only adjustment that I may potentially make if I wanted to be, you know, keeping everybody happy would mean let the coaches talk in freeze time.
I agree. I feel like...
You did it in 17.8 seconds. Well done.
Back in the...
Did you look at my elbow?
Yes, you know about that? It's just crazy in Australia.
We just
arrived.
Really?
Yeah.
How is that only a thing now?
Do you know how far away we are?
Good point.
Yeah.
Takes a long time to travel.
Yeah.
Anyway, what were we talking about?
We're talking about the coaching rule.
Coaching,
and
yes.
And you were talking about the freeze time.
Like we said, we did this all the time. I agree. I feel like it's a skill within CS you have to have.
100%.
And I think it's part of the game itself. And I agree with Valve in that respect. The only thing I don't agree with is obviously it's always going to be...
The fashion by which they did it.
Yeah, it's just like out of nowhere. There was like no real warning. Obviously, it's with the major, so everyone has to adjust. But it just felt like you've allowed it to get to this stage. And to be fair, like they're still keeping the role alive. It's not that they've completely cut it off. So the career is still there if you want to be a coach, right? It's just not as important as it once was. And it kind of takes away the in-game leader thing, which is fine. I agree. It was it's like ripping off a band-aid, right? You just have to get it done and say, right, this is it now. If you want to stay around, you've got some time before the next major to sort yourselves out. If you don't, get rid of your coaches.
In fairness to them, with the next major now being in 2017, as we know, it's the right time to change it.
Yeah,
I think if they were going to change it, it is the right time to do it.
But we did that to death. Anyway, so Group D, let's go through this one.
I'm Fnatic making it through. I'm going to make Dignitas number 2.
I would say that's probably quite fair. I think Fnatic, at that point, we kind of asked Lecro in the interview, said, do you think by January... for the major at least, but I'm not sure about this one.
Sweating.
Group D, what dates have we got for them? It's going to be 18th to 19th of November. That's not
that's
that
plenty
far.
Of time. They got a few LAN events under their belt in that meantime. But right now, if you were to say it, if I was to have to make a prediction right now based off what we know, it would be Dignitas, and I would maybe even go as far as saying Optic. I know that seems very, very left field, but
if Terra can get in there and get up to speed.
Dignitas have the best credentials so far. They've played the best brand of Counter-Strike, and they've done the best on LAN events that we've seen. Envy, you know, they're still a bit shaky. Fnatic, we don't know. They're an unknown entity, and I like Optic. I think I would love to know what happened with the whole DAP saga. It kind of just got swept under the rug.
So basically what did happen, I can talk a little bit about. So DAPS, and it was between DAPS and Stanislaw. So two Canadians, obviously. Tarek coming into the team, they wanted to make him sort of the star of the team. They wanted to build it around him with his experience on CLG. We know how good individually he can be. I think Mixwell is very good as well, by the way. And Rush can break out at times. I think we still need more from Rush. I think he's the key to the team at this point. But what happened? To stay on topic.
Go on.
DAPS was calling a style by which he was calling open round, but there was no adaptive calling in the mid rounds. Mm-hmm. And the team seemed very lost and disorganized during that time. So Tarek thought that Stanislaw was a little bit better in that situation. So that's where they elected to go. It was Tarek's, I wouldn't say Tarek's sole decision, but that was kind of the sentiment within the team. And I think Tarek was one of the motivators for that.
Carrying on a discussion about Envious when you were in the bog, I'm going to say they actually, at this point, they're going to be coming out with Dignitas, I think.
Oh. Fnatic's going to go out.
I think so. I think Envious, like we said, it's a very gradual increase right now. I think it'll be just enough by the time we get to that event. I think they'll be ready. And I feel like they'll be back. And I think they can do it with Dignitas.
I would say Fnatic over Dignitas. Envy over Dignitas and leave Fnatic still getting out.
Considering the new strategy I just gave Envious, they're probably winning every tournament.
They're just already,
yeah. They're winning the next major.
Make sure I send that email. Yeah. Don't let me forget. Anyway, to wrap things up, I think we've covered everything quite nicely there. We're looking forward to the tournament. It's happening from October 21st. That's when Group A starts. And then it's like pretty much every couple of weeks after that, right? So you've got October for Group A, November 4th to 5th, Group B. Group C, November 11th to 12th. Group D, November 18th to 19th. It's a really cool show. Check it out.
The good news is...
We won't be there.
It's perfect.
That's the good news.
It's actually... They line up with all the weddings in my life. So the finals coincided last time. Not that I don't think we would have been there anyway, but coincided with my brother's wedding. And this time it coincides with my best friend's wedding. So it's my vacation time every time E-League shows up.
Right.
Yeah, cool. E-League, sick one.
Done it.
Yeah, no, I liked it there. E-League was fun. Atlanta was nice.
Yes, yeah. You don't even have to be biased anymore.
Professionalism must have been
a freelancer. You actually thought it was a very well done tournament.
Yeah, they looked after everybody. They were
freelancers too, dude.
Wait, we haven't been there.
So we get a kiss ass until we go?
No, we just can't comment on how we've been treated. So we haven't been there.
I didn't know what
it was. Really nice. They looked after everything. We got business class flights, which pissed a lot of the other teams off. I think it was an accident. And all the other teams were like, why don't we have business class flights? I was like, I don't know, motherfucker.
Is that what you said in that voice?
Nah, I didn't.
With sunglasses on.
It was really good. Like, the only criticism that I would have made was some of the admins, not the main admin, the other admins they had helping seemed relatively incompetent. I don't know where they got them from. Probably just picked them up on the side of the street. But
yeah, North
that's
America.
The only thing that I think they could improve on. Having Richard there, you know, driving that ship is a pretty good thing to have. He's a switched on dude.
He is indeed. Well, then, that's...
I've seen him get pretty switched on.
This moves us on to our next discussion. You can tell we're in a different studio this week. Thank you very much to the lovely gentleman at ESL.
Are we not doing an intermission that we agreed?
Yeah, I'm just coming to that.
Oh, okay.
We've got to just do the formalities first, you know?
Sorry.
So thank you very much to ESL for allowing us to do this. Joe Miller, Matt Klein is in the back helping Tom out as well. He's taking time out of his own day to actually help us do this. So thank you so much. And we are going to take a very quick intermission. We're going to come back with Pro League stuff and we'll finish it off with the Asian documentary as well. So do not go anywhere. It's only going to get better from here. I promise. It is going to get better. So do not go anywhere and we'll be right back.
Hello and welcome back.
Hi. How are you?
Bloody Earth Cobber.
Well then, the next segment is going to be about ESL New York, an event you and I are going to, Matthew, but SPUNJ, you are not.
You are part of it, though.
You are part of it.
Joe the Miller has chained me to the desk.
Joe, don't call me Joe Miller.
Yeah, he's chained me to the desk here in Cologne, and I don't get to get on a plane.
But you're still part of the magic.
Mm. Yeah, I am. I'm very excited. I'll be casting.
Would you need a visa from Australia to go there anyway?
Nope.
No, I didn't think so.
I'm going on holidays.
It's a nice little holiday.
I'm just wondering, even for holidays, because now we
an ESTA. Do you classify an ESTA as a visa? It's a waiver program.
Just, we have the same thing from the UK.
I just travel down and say, "Hey, what's up, neighbors? Going in? Sorry." And then they say, no problem, just bring back your boots.
Eh? A boot.
And we say, that's all right.
Well, ESL New York, an event that's coming up very soon. Mm-hmm. 1st to 2nd of October, to be exact, and it's taking place in the Barclays Center in Brooklyn, New York. What an exciting venue that is, Matt. One of the big sports teams play there, don't they? What are the sports teams? The Knicks or something? Brooklyn Nets. That's what I meant.
Thanks, Matt.
One of those.
They shoot the ball into the hoopy thing.
Yeah. Three-pointers, yeah. Way downtown, all that stuff.
Getting the dunkaroos.
The dunkaroonies.
Dude. You guys have to be with me on this.
Go on.
You guys eat all the cookies and save the last circle one and just take all the frosting, don't you? And dunkaroos.
What's a dunkaroo?
What?
I know what a dunkaroo is. We're in Australia. They're shaped like kangaroos, right?
And you. No, okay. Well, it comes.
They aren't always.
Look them up and I'll tell them the same. In Canada, basically, you get a little packet.
Yeah.
It's covered in plastic and there's a compartment for all the cookies and a compartment for the frosting.
But they're.
There's kangaroos on them. Those are them. There's kangaroos on them. And so can we bring this full screen?
This, we can't pull this.
Well, cookie fans be like, best show I've ever watched.
No, this, you get pulled off YouTube for this shit. You can't put someone else's content up.
Yeah, that's true.
I had learned that from the Joe Rogan podcast.
Right. Well.
Wait, do you want to put it up?
No, we can't. We don't want to get pulled off
irrelevant,
YouTube.
Of course.
Yeah, it's. So this guy, see, I eat all the cookies first and then one big one with the frosting.
In Australia, they actually, the biscuits were shaped like kangaroos. Like the kangaroo character.
That makes so much sense.
Yeah.
Makes so much sense.
Well, I'm glad we cleared that up. Anyway, it is taking place in the Barclays Center, Brooklyn, New York, and a $250,000 prize pool. What a lovely event it's going to be, and another amazing venue, the CounterStrike, is going to take place.
Matt, why don't you run us through the teams?
Why don't you do that?
Yeah, okay. SKG2, Liquid, Virtus Pro, Navi, Fnatic, Astralis, and someone waiting to qualify.
Who's that?
Don't know yet.
It's between TSM, Optic, and Cloud9.
So,
did you say Cloud9 by accident? I think you did.
It wasn't an accident.
Fair enough. So this was why I was taken by those three teams as a qualifier, which I assume is online coming up in the next few days, presumably. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be using the Swiss format, which is something that's not we've had before in CS.
Not that spot.
Overall, I was a bit confused. Yeah, you're right. Overall, the tournament's using the Swiss format, which we had. What was the last one we used that? I can't actually remember.
The major qualifier in Katowice.
Is
it Katowice?
Katowice.
Okay.
So you can explain that.
I was involved in it.
Go on then.
It's a pretty good format. Basically, the Swiss format is you have one, well, in Poland we had two groups, but in this example, it's only one group of eight. And so the first round, you're randomly drawn an opponent. The teams that win, there are four teams who will win their opening matches and they move up to like the top four winners. Yep. And then the bottom four losers, they move down to their matches. So then randomly drawn again against the bottom, like the bottom four teams, they play each other and the top four teams play each other. Then it goes again, it splits one more time. You have teams, the two teams who won their matches again, two teams who won one, lost one, two teams who lost one, won one, and then two teams who lost both matches.
As soon as you lose two, you're out.
I think it's lose three, though, because...
I think it is lose three.
Yeah, once you've lost three, then definitively you're out. Like
Because there's two teams that go 0-2.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that makes sense. It's different than GSL, what we're used to seeing at the moment.
Yeah, I think teams like this format because you get more chances. And not only that, this kind of proves who the best team is because there's a high likelihood that you will play a majority of the squads. And if you know you know how sometimes you verse two teams and you get knocked out and go, well, if I was in another group, I could have made it. This way, there's no excuses. You're going to probably play... You're playing at least three teams.
And you're playing with all the weakest ones.
Exactly. You're playing against other teams who lost. So if you're a Liquid and you've lost your first game, you could be playing against... There's no real weak teams there. What am I saying? Whoever gets Liquid's laughing.
No, but it's true. I mean, you cannot argue that, I didn't have easy teams in my group. You're getting the easy teams if you lost.
It's a great system.
So before we get into our predictions and our thoughts, you can still buy tickets to this event. Like I said, it's coming the 1st and 2nd of October. I believe you have some sort of graphic. There it is. That's magic.
Hey.
So that's going to be telling you where you can go. So ESL-1.com. I think tickets still are available. It's going to be a hell of an event.
It's going to be a sick event. I'm really excited. I haven't been in New York City since I was about 12. We're going to have a whole lot of time to go around, but it's just...
We've got one day.
It's a fantastic place. Very busy, very chaotic. But there's something magical about that. And my parents are coming down.
Nice.
Yeah, it's like a second event they'll be at.
Yeah, amazing. So, get on our website.
Henry, how do you feel about New York?
Man, it's going to be fun.
I've never been. It's one of those iconic places you see in the movies, on TV, and you're told amazing things about it.
Are you going to go to Central Park? Is that the one they got in New York?
I've got one day to explore, so I will go there. I'll probably try and go to the Empire State Building, Statue of Liberty, all that stuff. Like the
Statue of Liberty
stuff.
Is a little bit... It's better to just see it from afar. I've never gone out to the island. If you've got time, go, I guess.
And
I
want to go see some of the nightlife as well. I want to see what the kind of vibe is there. So, yeah, I'm trying to use it.
Are you going to go on the hunt for some American vagine, or are you just going to...
Maybe. You never know. Yeah. Let's see if the mood takes me.
Henry, it's American Papine.
Oh. Papine, yeah. I'm not prejudiced. Either way, it's fine.
I just want to say that I'm probably just going to go to a Broadway play.
Nice. No, yeah. That's good. They have good shows there.
Very good shows.
Apparently so. Yeah. Very, famously. Very good
shows. I've never been, and I don't get to go this time. But I'll be casting from the studio with Mitch Uberschouts, a guy named Hugo, and potentially Lauren, aka Pansy.
Is Red Eye with you as well?
I don't think so. I think Red Eye's with you guys, but he'll be doing interviews from New York, and we'll
For your content.
I think I could be completely wrong.
Yeah, I think he's involved somehow in your broadcast. Anyway, yeah. So let's get into kind of the predictions and stuff like that. Let's have a look at the standout teams to kick things off. Like you said, no one's really weak here. I would say if you had to pick the underdogs, it'd be Astralis, Fnatic, Liquid, currently in the form. Mm-hmm. After, like you said, they're in the bin right now. So let's talk about Liquid first. We haven't really touched on them in this show at all. So Liquid, getting to the grand final of Cologne, looking like amazing for everybody, right? What a dream story that's been, with Simple coming back for Cologne. We didn't expect them to do it again, but they went one step further. They got to the grand final and actually put up a pretty good show as well. So they lose Simple, they bring Pimp in, and it seemed to I don't agree with you in terms of, like, it's completely shit the bed. I think it's definitely dropped off significantly.
No. Okay, so there's different phases of being in the bin. You can be in the bin,
okay,
and then you can be the bin juice. You know the bin juice at the bottom of the bag? If you become the bin juice, you're cooked, you're done.
Oof. Okay, so they're in the bin.
They're in the bin, but they can get out of the bin.
Okay.
You know, you might be like, oh, fuck, I didn't mean to put that in the bin, and get them out.
Okay.
But at the moment, they're just chilling.
Okay, so do we feel like they can make a dent in this tournament then?
No.
No. Not this time around?
I don't think so.
What do we feel? Say? We feel like Simple was the main factor for them. Do you feel like he brought that team together and he was the one that kind of fired them up? And, yeah?
You have a lot of confidence when you ever play like Simple. Some guy going around and just open people.
Yeah.
That'll fill you with confidence.
I can't say I've watched any of the online stuff since the addition of Pimp, so I don't want to speculate too wildly.
No one loses to CLG right now, and they lost to CLG.
Sub Rosa fans be like.
Reddit be like.
Sub Rosa fans. Oh, God, the in-jokes. It's great.
Let me see if I can find some of the matches here. Let's just quickly go over Liquid's previous.
Yeah, that's a good place to start. Let's see if we can start dissecting this.
So, like,
that's a lot of red.
Okay, so they lost to CLG on Mirage, but then they won a game on Cobble. They beat NRG 16-14 and 16-7. They lost to NRG. Holy shit!
Yeah.
They beat
E-United. That's pretty straightforward.
They lost to Echo Fox in two maps.
It's not looking good.
What's their current pro league standing?
They lost to La Renegades.
You know a little bit about those guys.
Australia, fuck yeah. Anyway, so I think their online form is not fantastic.
Here we go. I've actually got a tab open for American Pro League.
Wait, hold up.
Here it is. So right now, Liquid, there they are. What? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Seventh place. They've played. They've won 9, lost 9. So middle of the pack. They need to get top 6.
HCC will get me another one of those soon.
It's not. How many games do you play in total in this?
24 or 26 or something.
Okay,
like
so
that.
There's still chance to bounce back, right? They've only played 18.
No, but we just said they lost to. We said they lost to NRG and CLG.
Yeah, but they've still got games to play. They can still make top 6.
That's but that's. How many games do you play total?
Hold up,
24
one second.
Or something.
But who's under them with. Okay, so they're in all right. SK's obviously should catch them.
Okay, so here are the teams.
True. CLG, I don't think will. 3-11.
Can we actually bring this up on screen, please?
Here are the teams that Liquid still have to play. So if they should win, you'd consider them winning 3 out of these 4 series. They've still got 4 series to go, right? They have to play Complexity Gaming. They have to play Immortals, Splice, and Selfless. Well, you should expect them to beat Splice, Selfless, and Complexity, right? You should expect. I'm not saying they will, but you'd expect them to. Immortals would be the only one. So let's say they get those 6 Ws. What's that going to put them up to?
If you get 6 Ws on that, you're at 15 wins, which is top the league status, but they've already lost 9 and Immortals don't have much left. So the only teams that they're really in this against is Renegades and Echo Fox.
Okay, so if they sneak
maybe
in,
it'll
energy
be 6. If they tank the rest of the
year. But look at SK. They're down the bottom as well.
I know, SK's going to pass them. So I think it's between Liquid, Renegade, Echo Fox, Energy for the last spot.
Okay.
Last 2 spots, but I think Energy's probably fine where they've only played 16 games. Really, they don't, unless they crash. So it's Echo Fox, Renegades, Liquid. That's the battle.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Well, okay then. So we've looked at their form, and we're going to say that they're probably not going to do very well this event.
No.
I guess that's a safe assumption, and we can go back to us now.
I'm going to get my form off the ground.
So Liquid, we're
broken.
Kind of going to rule them out. Astralis, let's move on to the next underdog then. Astralis, we kind of covered their problems right now.
Mm-hmm.
I still feel like they're a dangerous team. They always have the ability to upset. They have got some phenomenal players, regardless of their current form, as players that can always turn up to events and completely destroy. Obviously, Device, Dupree, who did start out, he looked great as well, to be fair. These couldn't kind of finish things off once they got to the playoffs. But I feel like in terms of the top three underdogs, Liquid, Fnatic, Astralis.
Let's do it like we said we were going to do at the start of the show, especially because it does bottom up, and that's how the format works. So
let's assume.
Sense.
Let's assume who out of TSM, Optic, and Cloud9, which one of those Cloud three
nine.
Teams is going to qualify?
Cloud9.
Cloud9.
Let's assume it's Cloud9. Yeah.
So then let's run with that as our eight teams and go from there. So I think we're all going to agree.
Liquid's out first.
That Liquid is out first.
Liquid or Astralis?
It's best of ones, though, so there's always that chance. Like, there's I'm being a bit harsh on Liquid. I don't know why I'm being a dick today. Maybe I just woke up on the wrong side of the bed.
No, it's in fairness, you're being harsh and blunt about it, but they are struggling right now. There's no hiding that.
I think they know it. They would admit that they're struggling. They do have the talent.
They
like
have a boot camp right now,
Nitro, they're fucking sick players. JDM, also very good. Hiko, I don't, you know, he's great. It's just this pimp thing. So we already covered that. I'm just going to cover. I'm not being a dick. I'm just being funny.
And what a good job you do, Adam.
I'm punching down.
Right.
Yeah. They say you should punch up. Anyway, so I reckon Liquid last.
Okay, that's fair enough. I would say it's the next team coming in the door. I'd say either Fnatic or Astralis. I'm going to say Fnatic. I think they go up before
Jeez,
Astralis.
Man, you heard them, those guys. It's because you're an NIP fanboy.
I am.
Wow.
NIP fans, not even like. There.
Well, I just think that it's going to take a slow burner. I've always said about this team. I think there's a lot of potential. I think they will get to the top 10 eventually. But for now, I think they've got a lot of events to do. They've got some unexperienced callers there. Venton's apparently taking the calling roles.
Inexperienced,
yeah.
Triggered,
and it's going to be an interesting time for them to actually try and step up to an event like this. It's not like you can have the easy games. Every game's going to be really, really difficult for these guys. And playing on that big stage in the Barclays Center in Brooklyn, that's kind of nuts, right? And you're straight into it. This is their first real showing with them. I just don't feel like this is the event for them to have their breakout
and
performance.
And you might be onto something as well, because keep in mind, Astralis was the qualification team, and they took down people like Godsent, Mouse Sports... Who else? NIP, I think, was in that qualifier. So, you know, they did do fairly well to get there. So, all right. You're going to say Fnatic. I'm going to say Fnatic or Astralis next.
I'll agree with the Fnatic one there.
Okay.
So, we've got 8th place, Liquid. 7th, Fnatic. Then we say Cloud9 or Astralis. Where are we going that one?
I'm going to go Astralis.
Ooh. Yeah, the home field advantage for Cloud9. I reckon that's going to pump them right up. So, yeah, let's go Astralis in third last.
Third last. And then, okay. So, then we've come to Cloud9. So... I would say next step is G2, Virtus Pro. Oh, it's difficult,
nine.
Isn't it? Cloud9 is like, this
Na'Vi,
is difficult.
Na'Vi, SK. That is a tough. I'd say get rid of Cloud9 at that point, and it's a fucking... It's a doozy. He's stressing. He's stressing.
Is this what it said there?
Hold on. I don't even know what it said.
It's just like about sucking dicks.
Yeah, he actually did. Yeah. And I'm
you guys on this analyst
scream.
Desk. Jesus Christ.
Analyst desk.
So,
the good news is I'm in prime position to go skiing.
Nice.
That would me be longboarding. okay, where am I going with this? So, sorry, we'll bring up the screen eventually. I'm going to get it ready. So, Liquid.
You're going to put this on the screen?
Yeah, it's a great.
You're
going to
put that on the screen. Can you change the text? It's like
no,
a little bit
no,
more juicy.
No, don't do it. No.
Liquid, Fnatic. Let's just keep track of what's going on now. Fnatic. Okay, then we went with what? Astralis. And five. We're going in with what? We're saying Cloud9? Or where do you want to go with this one?
I think it's safe to say Cloud9, but, you know, these are like the most likely predictions, what we're doing right now, you know? They're not... Like, once you see the matchups, then you can make a better set of predictions. This is based off of knowing the teams, and we're still guessing the Cloud9 factor. So let's say that Optic somehow blew out. I would even be inclined to potentially put Optic in the last spot, you know?
Yeah.
So, but we're basing off of, okay, we're picking Cloud9. Not only that, we're assuming that the matchups will work out.
YNK with his traditional greeting in chat.
Hello, you cunts.
G1.
Okay, this is where...
Are you putting SK in first? I'm going to... See, this is where we need to have
I was just
debate.
Giving them as a placeholder for now.
Okay.
So
just
no,
so,
you're not.
Just so I can cut and paste people out, you know? Just
sucking that Brazilian dick.
I'm going to go... I'm going to make a prediction right now. I'm going to say Na'Vi wins.
Okay. Well, sorry, SK. You've been relegated.
Control C.
Yeah, I pressed the wrong one.
Right?
It's a German keyboard. I'm not
Isn't
about
drinking
that.
Water, right, bottled water out of a glass bottle, the most pretentious fucking thing in
yeah,
the world?
Yeah, a little bit. But I know the thing is glass deteriorates in a faster manner than plastic. So Prince Edward Island, which is a beautiful little section of Canada, you can only have glass bottles there because they don't want to ruin the environment.
Plus, you
so
can stab a
like
cunt
it.
With it.
You can definitely stab a cunt with it. I prefer to stab a cunt with something else, but you can do glass if you want. I don't think she'll like it very much.
Yeah. Are we saying this is the first tournament that Na'Vi can win? Do we feel like this is the one?
I think SK, right, I am a fallen fanboy. I like that team. I like the dynamic of that team. I think that the way that he kind of rallies his troops and the way that they've designed their game plan and stuff, they've revolutionized the way that Counter-Strike is being addressed. I think Na'Vi have cottoned onto that in terms of the pace changing, going from really slow and then really fast and set. They've kind of do a very similar thing. So those two teams, for me, are the best two Counter-Strike teams at the moment. However, SK seem to be struggling a little bit. Now, I know it's only online. I don't want to rule them out. When it comes to land, they're going to fire the fuck up. They're going to do their huddles, and you get goosebumps just watching that shit. So I don't want to say that they're going to drop off, but I could see them potentially not making the final. I could see them being in that third place. Yep. However, I would love to see a Na'Vi SK final, and then I wouldn't care who wins.
Can you imagine that? That would be so sick, actually, with the new complexion of Na'Vi, maybe finding some form. We've got a little bit more time this time, I guess, but still, that would be, for me, that's the dream final,
yep.
I think. Na'Vi SK, a bit of an El Clasico there. That would be absolutely mind-blowing if we got that final.
That would get GB James aroused.
Probably. Mm. Matt?
Are you busy there, Matt?
You a bit busy?
Yeah.
You on the Score Esports app?
No, definitely not. I go on there, but there's no games right now that I need to be on there for. There's the Gfinity, but whatever.
Okay.
Yeah, we were going to do that, but it's not... Okay, we were going to do it. It's not really a real tournament, though, is it? It's kind of like more of a show match.
Plus, it's because I wasn't invited. You guys said
we weren't invited either.
It's not that. Okay. It's just we're supposed to be trying to limit the show to an hour, and we're already at 40 of them.
This didn't feel like a proper tournament, right? It was kind of like... It seemed like more show matches.
You don't have to justify it. We just think there's shit. No, I'm kidding. We don't think that.
It was just like a little show match. It felt like more than anything. Like, they're doing it at a conference called EGX, and I'd love to. There's not enough time in the day. We'd love to do everything.
You would love to be there for Twitch reasons.
Expo's the worst place, right, to play Counter-Strike.
I was talking about Twitch, Henry. We like hanging out with Twitch.
How many Expos did you play in, Henry, in your time?
How many was there?
Expos, like when you played events.
Oh, we did.
Fucking horrible, man.
I never actually did any of those.
Never did
any? Never
worst thing in the world.
What, when you actually got, like people there and, like, music
it's because the
festivals
fucking
going
the
on
bass
next door.
And your desk is shaking and you can't hear shit. It's the worst.
I guess the nearest we had was, like, the iSeries stuff where you have, like, a big LAN going on at the same point. You're playing around you, everyone in the BYOC. That's as close as it got, but nothing like that. No.
Yeah.
So I can imagine. I've heard of Gamescom. Did you play that? You were Gamescom, right? That was probably the worst one.
It's where it came third at IEM.
Yeah, you hold on to that one, don't you?
I like that format. I think it was kind of fun. We did the Barcelona this year, too.
How many people can say they came third at an IEM?
Everyone who did.
Exactly.
So.
That's what we think.
Na'Vi SK final. That's my dream anyway. I think that's a really cool point.
That's the best rivalry in CS.
I think G2, they're going to be always an exciting team to watch there. Like the way Shoxi is playing right now. Like I think for me, when he's in that kind of form, he actually does take the title with the best player in the world at some points when he's playing like that for me. So, I feel like they're always going to be a danger man if he's on form.
Can someone
go on
mod Sponge so we can ban this guy?
What's he doing?
He's spamming a link.
Spamming a link.
Don't click the links, guys.
Don't click the link. He's about to get banned. It's fine.
Anyway, let's stay on topic.
Yeah, let's stay on topic. So, ESL New York, it's going to be a hell of an event. Matt and I will be there. Sponge will be bringing you the online content. We feel like Na'Vi SK, that'll be the final. But you have got teams like G2, VP there. You've got the bottom end of the table as well. We kind of predict that Astralis, Fnatic, Liquid. Interesting to see what Fnatic, first gauge of them on land, right? The younger players, you've got Wenson, Lecro, and we're going to see whether they can step up under the helm of Olaf Meister and Dennis as well. Obviously, lots of cool storylines.
That's great storylines.
It's going to be a fantastic event overall. Like, every game's going to be really good. There's no...
Hang on, I think I have mod on mine now.
We'll keep going. We'll let him do this. But with the storylines that we're talking about, right, like, it's good to see if SK can recover from the time off with Foe. It's going to see if Na'Vi can take their online performance with Simple to land after the Kiev struggle. G2, they're always hovering around this, you know, top-tier mark. Are they able to break through, do another final, and then prove themselves? VP, we know that they're the old dogs. We know that they can play fantastic Counter-Strike. Can they do it in America on an awesome stage? Mm-hmm. Cloud9, the home heroes.
Yep.
Can they use the hype of the crowd to push them through further deeper into the tournament? Astralis, how are their struggles going to go? Are they going to overcome what appears to be some issues, maybe with leadership? Fnatic, like you were just saying, new kids on the block, how are they going to fare? Is this going to be another Fnatic brand to be scared of? And Liquid,
Can they get out of the bin? Yeah, I think that's a nice little summary, Chad. And I think that probably does the event justice. We will be there. I'm going to bring the graphic up one more time just so you can check it out. Please go buy the tickets. It helps us out. Can yourself be very kind to us to allow you to studio. And this is all part of it.
I will. If you buy a ticket right now because of this show and show me.
Tweet it at Saticus.
Tweet it that you bought it because of the show or you saw this show and you have a ticket. I will try and make a point of meeting you.
Lovely stuff. We'll do a meet and greet. We're quite good at those. They seem to go down well in America.
Yeah, they were all right. We're pretty good. We'll try and make it happen. It's one of those things, like I say, I'm going to, but I'll try. We're kind of busy during those events times too.
But we'll try and do one of these.
Can we switch topics?
We can.
Can we switch to my favorite obsession, Asians?
Yes, we can.
I thought that was Moses's favorite.
Okay. I'm not actually that into them, but Moses is favorite.
The way we're going to do this is, right, we've got a really cool documentary coming out. I want to talk about it more afterwards. I want you to kind of build this up, why we've done this video, and then hit
the
play button.
We did this video because our main...
Let me finish. Then we're going to hit the play button. It's going to be a really cool, explosive 12 minutes, and we're all going to have goosebumps. Then we're going to come back and have a chat about it.
I'm really excited.
We brought him on the show specifically. He's played against these guys a number of times, and you can kind of tell your experiences against them and all that stuff. So without further ado, Matthew, could you use your words and generate as a segue into this piece?
Here's the piece.
No, don't be one of those motherfuckers.
Well, he's like built it up already, and then he's asking me to build on top
because you're really good at words.
Talk about it.
All right, listen, in all seriousness, we've done a lot of good features this year. I think there's no doubt about it. We started off with the Finnish guys. We did an Alu piece the day before he got transferred. We've done the Lekro piece. We had a cool little piece with Semler, but this one I think kings them all. This is 12 minutes. It talks about a scene that's still building. And I honestly think is 2017, it's their year, and watch out because Asia's actually going to sweep us by storm and we can start making EUCS jokes in chat. So we'll take a look at this.
In South Korea, my home country is actually homeland of esports. And even my parents' generation, they know what is professional gaming. A lot of the professional gamers in Western world, they studying and gaming as well. What we call professional gamer in China or Korea, that means full-time job. They woke up 2 p.m. and then they will study for the individual training. And then they going to start actual practice from the 5 to 6 p.m. They playing until the midnight. And after that, they will make the team discussion for what they did in today. Not only just discussion, but they actually training to fix it by themselves until like 4 to 5 a.m. Their practice time per day is like, I think, more than 10 hours. Almost everything will be monitored. And that's the kind of typical system of Korean esports. It is really different mindset, and the media exposure is really, really big from everywhere in South Korea. Our job, especially our coaching staff's job, is let them understanding this is not only just for fun, but it's more than serious than you. When 1.6 came out, a few Chinese teams and a few Korean teams, they showed up.
Fully loaded round right here. And if Lunatic can win this again, they can.
It all started like 2005. There were leagues in Korea, in South Korea, in Seoul, where a lot of the top teams from the world were invited to. And there were Korean teams playing there. We'd known they'd been to a few events previously, but they hadn't really done all too much because they didn't have a lot of opportunities to compete internationally, just like it is nowadays.
Lunatic's going to be in trouble. They need to rush. Fisker, a really big kill.
Everybody's blind. Fisker with the third.
And at that time, Korean teams was just lagged all the time. So my boss asked me, okay, you go to find the best players who have best potential. So I gathered Solo and Tommy. They formed as a team Predict KR. And then they practice a lot. And when Seasons came back to Season 3, they destroyed everybody. Even I still remember the one moment, this was like a semi-final against NIP. Even Heaton was in the active lineup, but Solo just made the ace. I couldn't believe that moment. That was a huge moment, like a Korean Counter-Strike scene. And even the Chinese Counter-Strike team, WMV, they won that tournament.
Yes. WMV has won the championship, WEG 2005 season 3.
Project KR, that eventually became We Made Fox and Eastro afterwards. They had a lot of international high placings in big tournaments. The next year, 2006, was when we saw the first real results from the Asian teams. I think one thing that really separated the Asian teams was that their work ethic is just immense. They can dry run things for like 10 hours, you know, going through strats, practicing smokes and flashes, and they would be able to just win right on how good they were at aiming.
Unfortunately not. The buy back now.
Oh my god.
The biggest star for me has to be Solo. My first encounter with this guy was basically at a CPL event in Dallas, Texas. I was doing a shootout for a company, basically a one-on-one CS 1.6 aim map. And then I noticed a bunch of Asian kids, and I did recognize one of them. He's the one that sat down. I was looking at him like, I know this guy from somewhere. Turns out it was Solo, and he wrecked the shit out of me.
Before I joined to this organization, the team owner, his name is Choi, he asked me, what about the potential of the Counter-Strike global offensive? At that time, we brought the one team in Korea to our brand, and then I recommend that we need to some veteran to coaching them. So we brought Termi as a coach. But when they actually started the practice, Termi realized that he still have a chance, and his old teammate from the We Made Fox, they were had a full-time job, but I realized that the one guy, Solo, he's the key. So one day, I called to Solo in person. Well, Solo, you are like 28, 29 years old, you're still young. One thing if I want to say you right now is, when you going to die, are you satisfied and happy, or are you going to regret the entire life? And then he said, no, that's how we have a two squad.
I think it's very cool that the old We Made Fox lineup is back intact and playing. You know, it was always a great hype in them meeting up with the big dogs, but it has been quite a few years. And so it's going to be very tough for them to get back into it. And I think they'll definitely have their work cut out, but at the same time, it's going to be super exciting to watch them and see them progress and, you know, how they fare against today's top players.
My expectation is, as far as they found the team works, they will be very strong.
To make this game truly global, we definitely need to have the Asians as a part of it, because they bring this very different idea of what grinding the game truly means. They'll play the game until their fingers bleed. There's a running joke about how they're the Korean overlords because of how much they spend on actually playing the game. I think slowly but surely, as long as they get more of these opportunities to play against the top teams, they will definitely be a part of that top 16 pool in the world that make the majors even. You know, Tyler wasn't even that far off from making the major at the last qualifier, so I think it's only a matter of time and a matter of them getting the opportunities before they are similar to the European teams that are doing well.
That shut it down. This time, similar scenes, but it's the exact opposite. It's very aggressive. They're not playing the defensive style. They're actually hunting for kills, shutting down the economy of Na'Vi on the T side. They couldn't ever get rolling.
And remember, Tyloo as well. Malmo, very successful. Unfortunately, couldn't make it to E-League. They were also in the qualifier for the MLG major. Couldn't make it to that because of these issues. If these guys were in the Western scene more, this could be the first Chinese team we really see make an appearance in the top 10.
They don't get the practice against.
I think more than anything else, they need to have more tournaments in their own respective regions, and also more opportunities to compete at international tournaments so they can get experience more than anything else. But I think they're going to be bigger contenders in the future, for sure. it's one thing to see how they play, it's one thing to review demos of what's going on and how are things set up, but it's another thing to actually live in those situations and react to the things that happen in a game. As I wear the t-shirt behind of the players. Yeah, 1.6 small number, huge memory. But as long as big companies, especially the Korean companies, all like knock the door of the game, I believe Asian teams in general, they will participate in two major series in a year. And I think in second year, I think they will achieve something very memorable. It's like a time bomb. We know it's going to be exploded very soon. More like we are coming.
That's emotional.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I was like, how do we get back?
That was really good.
Segue. That
was
awesome. That.
Good, right?
Yeah. Tom did a great job.
Very good work. Very talented young man. He's been working for us throughout this show, and I think that's his best work yet. Like, he's had enough time to really show us what he's capable of, and that was actually very emotional. I just feel a bit kind of, I don't know. I don't even know what the emotion is right now. Is this like sadness or I couldn't put a finger on it.
For me,
it's anticipation.
Yeah. When I think of 1.6, though, like, even I never got to play on like the global scale of 1.6, right?
Yeah.
But that was the first FPS game that I took seriously, and I played competitively. And I had a team of mates who we all, you know, had the same Lancer and that kind of stuff. And the emotions from 1.6 to me, and I watched the tournaments there that they showed. Like, that's when I was like looking up and going, "Fuck, that's what I want to do," right? To me, those memories are fantastic for that reason, because I experienced them. I remember more about 1.6 events that I wasn't even at than I do about my own competitive career as a CSGO player. And that says something, I think. But Mr. Kan Yang, the original esports gangster, he has done a lot for the Asian scene. And I remember him in the CGS days. Like, he was involved then as well. Like, that's obviously later after the 1.6 and stuff. But I remember him. I met him back then. And he's always been so passionate about the Asian scene and you know, Korean esports especially. And, you know, you need someone like that in your industry or your country to push it across, and hopefully they can make a good team.
So I guess the question is now, do we feel like they can ever live up to the levels we saw in 1.6, and what the foundations are there? We've got teams emerging and they're showing decent results. Do we feel like they've got the tools required right now to actually be coming to more events and actually showing us they can compete against the top tier level? That's the big question,
I guess. I think, yes, they do. I mean, we saw Fancy in a crazy 1v3 pull it off with Isolated Peaks. We saw Captain Mo go nuts. We saw shots from Savage in there that were in the video. There was a lot of things that point to the fact that the team is ready. The issue for me is that they don't have the tools given to them. They're working against, you know, the Valve not giving the Asian support, the Crossfire being free at the gaming cafe where a lot of the people in those countries go to play, specifically in Korea. Now, I do know for a fact that there is going to be some of that changing. I don't know what it's going to be, but Valve is looking, and we know that from being at the Miner, to implement something very different in the Asian regions coming in the next few months to try and bring them on board. And that's why I think 2017 is the year of the Asians. And there's a couple things, very exciting. And that's why I say anticipation is what I feel, because I'm anticipated to see what happens. And I'm a little bit excited about it. Now, there's a couple things in the video that, if you're newer to CS, you're going to watch it. And I think the video went on to explain it well. But, you know, they say esports in Korea is more serious than EU. Well, if you're a newer CounterStrike fan and you only really watch CounterStrike as an esport, you're going to go, well, how the hell can you say that? And you're not winning games. Every single esport that has an Asian representation has had an Asian domination period at one point in time. There's no doubt about it. Dota 2, League of Legends, StarCraft, name anything. They've had an Asian
1.6
domination.
As well.
1.6 as well, and that's exactly the point. So there's no question they take it very seriously and that they're very regimented. And the fact that the older generations know about it, it's welcomed, it's embraced. The structure within the community is there. It's just that CS hasn't had the support.
I think that's spot on. You know, they need more support and stuff. But I also think that, you know, Tai Lu is a team who individually as players, they're all very talented players, right? They all have fantastic aim. They have really good movement. The way that they approach the game is different because they are so isolated. But Nadu's talking about their will to practice and how they practice so hard at dry runs and all that kind of stuff, right? And, you know, they probably do a lot of deathmatch. They probably would like to play more matches. But when you live in China or even South Korea, it's very difficult to play against a lot of different opponents of higher skill levels, right? Because Tai Lu are the most dominant team there at the moment, and then you've got VG. You see them every second week playing each other in a final. They need more diversity to be able to get better, you know? Even if they know all this stuff, even if they know we need to have more depth of strategies, we need to have more executes, we need to have better ways to rotate, we need to have, you know, refine our communication, our aim needs to be on point. Like, you can dry run until the cows come home, but decision-based Counter-Strike, when things aren't going your way, if you do a strat and you get blocked by a Molotov, or if a guy pushes and kills somebody and you can't do that, how you adapt there is more important, especially in high-pressure matches, because shit happens. And shit happens all the time in high-pressure matches. So they need more experience playing at the top level, and I think the only way they can achieve that is if they can, you know, grab a visa somehow, get themselves over to Europe or America and compete at that high level.
We talked a lot about that.
Right? Tyler was supposed to be there, and it's just such a difficult scenario coming from a country like China. Obviously, a lot of political issues there, and it's difficult to say to the guys, right, we're leaving this country, we're going to go to America for 6 months and play a computer game. And it's a very difficult, hard sell to make, right? So it's... I wonder who was there. There he goes. Just one.
I had to look into the light and get rid of it. Yeah.
It's a very difficult task to do that. It's not like coming from Australia to America, right? That's obviously still a complicated process with visas and stuff.
We've never gone on holidays.
Oh, right, of course. But
with
China, that's a really different kind of
thing. The thing with E-League as well, though, is yes, it's more experience, and there is a good number of games within the group, but it is still a group stage. I think they need longer than that. They need a season. They need something.
Here's what I suggest.
Or more tournament. That, by the way, that's the other thing. All tournaments at this point. The one we just had at Kiev is the last one that Asians have a chance to qualify for in 2016. Yeah. That's pathetic.
Here's what I reckon we do. I reckon we boot out two of the shitters from Pro League.
Okay.
Complexity and some other motherfuckers. Kick them out. See you later. Get out of there. Let's all petition the US government.
Get Tai Lu in.
Suck some dicks. Do whatever we got to do. Get Tai Lu and VG in. Right, throw them in. That will be a super competitive league. Cloud9, Immortals, SK, Tai Lu, Vici.
Problem is that North America's already been half the league's not even North American.
It's
because the visas are easier to get there.
I don't think that. I honestly, because the North American region is not as strong as the European region, right? Let's make the North American region as strong as possible, and let's get the best teams in there. And then you can go, well, fuck you, EU, because North America.
And then you get PEA, and you get WESA, and you get a world final through the majors.
Nice, let's do it. Lead the esports world.
All right, we'll start our own organization. It'll be called DropTheBombtv.
I said I was going to start Dick Wagger's Esports Association last week, but we could probably go with DropTheBombtv. That's probably a better
decision.
And we've
got the first three founding members here at the desk right now. So, Chad, you haven't got your picture on the board yet. What is this?
Yeah, well, I don't want one if it looks like I'm stuck in a cock.
That is the worst photo of me ever, by the way. I think you actually went to our graphic guy and were like, hey, can you use this? Like, I think you fucking sabotaged me.
Ready to go. Wide to receive. Yeah, that's nice. But yeah, just we wanted to touch on it. Obviously, we're a little bit late to the party, but we wanted to produce a really sick piece, right, and to show you everything that's kind of brewing there at the moment, how it is coming. That's the headline, right? We all think it is going to be coming at some point. 2017, I think you're right, Matt. That's the year. We're just getting really interested. I think Star Ladder was an amazing event for them to show they can knock down some really top-level teams there, like taking out teams like Virtus Pro, Na'Vi, that Tai Lu Na'Vi game on Mirage. I think that was pretty legendary considering the way they approached it. I'm not sure if you caught it, Chad, but you saw the kind of play style that they actually operated with. They were playing like two rifles, aggressive on short, almost every single round, and a sort of rifle squad just changing positions each for every single round, and like just showing how high the skill ceiling can be on those guys. And it's kind of scary to watch sometimes when they're operating at 100%. Like they're kind of nuts to play against. This is what I wanted to ask you, Chad. The Asian Minor we were at in Seoul, you had a chance to play against a lot of these teams. And was it something you noticed in terms of like the skill level? Was there quite a disparity? Do you feel like, these guys are just shit hot right now? Like, we have to lock them down through strategy. What was the kind of feelings when you were playing against
them? Just a different play style, very unrelenting. Yeah. So in terms of skill, I think their raw skill in terms of aim and stuff was on like par better than us. Mm-hmm. I think Azar is like one of the best players
in that
region, right? Yeah. And I think they were on par aim-wise with him. And he's a player who I, you know, always talk highly about. And if you can be on par with that guy, then you're sick. That stuff for them was awesome. I really liked, you know, how they played the game, and they were unrelenting in the way that they ran you down. The playstyle difference that I noticed was, especially on that cage game, and I don't know how we couldn't adapt to it, they just kept hitting B versus us. You know, Tai Lu, they just kept going B. We stacked at some rounds. We couldn't do anything. Like, we just couldn't stop them. They would take the site so well, they would trade out so proficiently, and it wasn't like they would do a default across the map. Even if we pushed other areas of the map, it didn't matter. They were like, well, we're still taking this bomb site and we're going to hold it. And that was something that was different. I think other things you noticed different was the way that they did a different Mirage hold, where they were playing two on catwalk to cover middle.
That's right, yeah.
Well, that was a counter-strike to an RV.
Yeah, but I think that's great. That this is the thing. You have all these demos and stuff that you can watch of Vici versus Tyloo finals. But it's pointless. Those teams know each other so
well.
It's like
G2 Envy, right?
You're not going to learn anything.
Kind of thing.
Yeah, you're not going to learn anything from those demos. So watching them, you know, you can go, okay, well, this guy plays here and this guy plays here. You know, that's a rough indication, but you can't go in depth. And these dudes, they can watch you. They watch you year round and they get their 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 opportunities over the year, and they're going to come for you because, like was said in the video, they do practice really hard. And I think their mentality is, hey, look, we know that we can prove ourselves. We don't get a shitload of money like the other regions, and we want to prove it. Whereas, you know, some other regions, it sucks to say, but it is the case. I think it's with Australia, the UK, and America, and maybe Canada to some extent. I'd assume I'll throw you in that group.
Sure, I'll let you know if you're right or wrong.
The mentality is, like, sure, we want to be good at the game, mm-hmm. and we want to win and stuff, but we're almost entitled countries in the sense that, you know, if you hit a certain level and you're good enough, well, it's not like, oh, yeah, we're just going to stop practicing
and shit.
It's
the work ethic's not there.
Yeah, it's not there. Yeah. And it's just a Western country thing. I think, like, Europe, on the other hand, I don't know how they're so different from us, but, like, oh, I know how Brazil's different from us.
I think the other thing as well is that I don't want to make this about, like, first world, second world, third world, but we have, like, this sense of, like, I don't even think it's entitlement in that sense, but, like, if we weren't playing CS, you know, we're doing enough to make money. We don't have to practice to make this our job. If it's not our job, we've got something else we can do. Whereas maybe in the Asians, they seem committed to it. Like they say, it's more established. The parents all know what it is. It is a legitimate career, and they know that we have to work for this. So there's no getting burnt out. It's just your job. You've committed to it.
In Korea as well, it's considered a very high profession to have. Kangnam was actually telling me that the fact is they have some of the younger guys in there, even like 19, 20 years old. They have a meeting with their parents once a month, come in and actually say, look, is my son going to make it? Do you think it's cut out for it? Is it time to pull the plug? Do you think he's good enough to do it? They have to have actual meetings coming in and with the organizers and actually say, like, well, the organization, I should say, and actually that's the kind of level it's on, right? It's like, look, is he wasting his time here? Do you think, like, he's going to be committed to this? It's not like a hobby. It's not like we do when we were practicing, we were like 17, 18, you're playing when you finish school or job. This is all in for them. And it's obviously, if you do that for 3 years, you don't make it, you've wasted 3 years of your life, right? But so they actually have that, the parents meeting coming in for 19, 20 year olds to actually work out whether this is the career for them. And these organizations have to advise them and say, look, we see some real talent in this guy. We think he can make it. We're going to take him under our wing, give him all the tools he needs, and we think we can craft him into a top player. So it's kind of exciting to see that. That's the disparity between the work ethic of someone in South Korea and then something like you said, the other Western countries.
It's like you said, too, they take it seriously. They know it's a job. They know it's a well-respected career, and therefore, where it is the career, they want to work for it. Whereas I think the entitlement comes from the fact that, oh, I was good in pubs. I was good in the community. Now I'm a pro player. I've done enough. I'm a pro player.
Yeah, I know people want to be like the best they can possibly be and stuff, and they tell themselves that. But these guys have another gear.
Well, so I'll use hockey as my example because that's what I played, right?
Yep.
If it was all just for fun, I would just play. I want to play games all the time. I would want to, you know, scrim at practice every time. That's it. Just straight up scrimmage, you know, scrimmages the whole time, and you never really get anywhere. But you know what? I'm having a good time. But to be the best, and we knew the steps were all there. We knew it was competitive. We knew there was other people that wanted to go to be a pro hockey player, and that was a legitimate goal. You go to practice and you'd fucking bag skate for two and a half hours. You'd come off the ice and you could hardly walk. Like, there was practices where my dad used to have to carry me to the car because I could hardly fucking untie my skates. And you know what? No one complained. You'd all groan a little bit, but you did it because it was something you wanted to achieve. And I think in CS, playing pro sometimes, some of these guys say, oh, well, yeah, I want to get better. But they won't do that. They won't go in and throw the Stetnade 1,000 times. They won't fucking line up a crosshair placement. They won't play until their fingers bleed. No, that's not healthy. But, you know, metaphorically speaking, right? And I think that's just because the structure is so loose. And in Korea, like you're saying, they have these interviews. Everyone's vying for that one spot. And it's not about being a pro and being the best, or, you know, if I'm good, I'll become a pro inevitably. It's I have to be better than this guy, and I have to be better than this guy. And whatever he's doing, I have to do it 10 times more.
Yeah. So then, in terms of what we see coming from the future, I think Tyloo is definitely the headline ad coming from that region. Mm-hmm. We don't really know what they've lined up for next, do we? Do we have any sort of indication of what their next event is? I don't think it's been announced as of yet.
I think there's some Asian events obviously going on. There's the one right now. Exactly. But as mentioned by Peter from HLTV, there's no further tournaments that they can qualify for in 2016. I think that's a huge bummer. That's a huge bummer. I think at this point in time, there needs to be pressure applied on organizations to make sure the Asian representation is better.
Hats off to Starlight, though.
I think, well, hats off to Starlight. later indeed. Remember, that event was actually supposed to be in Asia as well. Yeah. But I also think that Valve is going to make a push for a lot of that stuff. And I think Valve, remember back for the first majors, they had qualifications for India. Team Wolf was there. They had Bravado.
They invited some Australians.
Yeah, exactly. Fucking cunts. But they only got three rounds of Bravado, and yet still somehow... you know, they had a spot. Not that it wasn't deserved. They, you know, they run a qualifier. It made the game. But that's not the point that I want to make. The point is that it was global and there was efforts made. I think maybe Asia deserves a qualification spot for on their own, because Australia at this point, if you go to minors, you've got to play in that region, sure. But you guys have so much more experience. You've played in, you know, North America. I think that they should be qualifying through that avenue now. And I think the minor system, I like it. I like that it's a regional rule, but that should only apply to teams that aren't already established in a different region.
So then, the last line used in that video was, it's a ticking time bomb. It's going to explode at one point. Do we think that's going to happen? Do we really think there's a chance that that's going to be a case where they make it as top 10 teams in the world?
So with what Cam was saying about Solo and Termi and stuff, and Bale, I assume, all those guys, we haven't seen them play. How long have they been back as a team? Do you guys have any insight on this?
He mentioned it. Like, this is the thing. I don't know anything about that at all, really. Like, obviously, they haven't seen...
There was an announcement. It kind of got swept away in the midst of endless news.
It's just surprising that they haven't played anything. You know, like, you'd expect them to have played a tournament. Are they just practicing?
Solo return to CSGO, maybe.
Yeah, that would help.
Yeah. Korean Legends return and MVP PK.
Yeah.
So that's the other thing as well. MVP is an organization. This kind of works because they're three-letter orgs, but Red Eye touched on this. They all have Project is the team name, so MVP Project, MVP Reborn, Vici Reborn, or whatever it is.
So everyone they pick up, they keep the original name, and they pick
Solo,
up on the MVP
Termi,
brand.
Glow, Zef, Perry.
Yeah, there's no Bale. Poor Bale.
So, yeah, I can't see. I've seen them at all, but obviously that's another exciting prospect. Those are the legends coming back, right? And let's see whether there's still life in the old dogs. And maybe, Chad, as you would say, roll back the years. And
rolling back the years, definitely.
Yeah, see if they can do that, you know? Maybe that's a possibility. So final thoughts, gentlemen, on that subject.
Great show. We definitely need to work on timing. We went two hours long today. But it's going to give some people who listen to the sound bites and want to watch on VOD a lot to listen to and a lot to go through.
These are really good. I listen to podcasts.
There is one thing we have to do still, by the way.
Oh, yes,
we do. One last thing.
Thank fuck you're here.
Yes. Okay, so...
I'm here.
Guys, there is a giveaway this week with our partners, Fanatic Gear. Last time we did with the mouse, which is called the Flick, we did the Flick of the Week, where you send in your clips and you showed us your craziest flick shots of the AWP and the AK and all that sort of thing. This time we're giving away the Rush keyboard. It's the one most of us use, actually, when we're in our little team in the back room.
Yeah.
It's a very nice mechanical keyboard.
This is their strong point.
It's basically, it hasn't got any of the bullshit features you don't need. It's just a nice, solid keyboard, mechanical keys, red switches on this one. Actually,
you can get them in all three.
Yeah, that's right. You can choose. So your preference is the really nice, simple keyboard that does the job. I believe a lot of the SK guys use this keyboard as well. And the Fnatic guys obviously use the keyboard. And it's actually a really nice bit of kit.
I use it. My brother uses it. It's pretty sick.
If you'd like to pick one of these up, we're doing a thing. Here we go. Look at that. Beautiful.
Wrong camera, though. It's that one.
There we go. if you'd like the chance to win one of these beauties, all you're going to do, this one's called The Rush, right? So I came up with the idea of hashtag defend the rush. So if you can send in your clips of you getting the big spray downs against like a Rush Beyond Dust 2, like basically a rush into a bomb site, you're a CT, terrorist coming in. If you can defend one of those.
It can be op shots down in B tunnels as well.
I want a crazy single one clip spray.
What if it's an op collateral? Like four people rushing in.
That's true as well. That works.
Yeah, okay.
You can interpret it how you want. I'll be looking for the star points with one clip spray downs. But if you can send those in, hashtag defend the rush, we're going to announce it properly tomorrow. We'll get a graphic made up and everything. This is kind of just to give you a little taste. We'll give one of these away to the winners. We've already given away a mouse. And yeah, let's thank you to Fanatics for sponsoring us. We're going to do cool stuff, engaging giveaways instead of just retweeting stuff. I think this is more fun.
It is way more fun. And we get to see some cool. I like watching fun highlight clips. Some of them are pretty trolly. Our flick ones are pretty fun.
We got 100 entries last time. So if you want to do that, it's a nice, easy way. We've got a clip there. As long as it's a competitive game, it doesn't look like it's bullshit, like you've done it with your mates on the server.
Yeah.
We'll consider it.
You fucking set that up, you little punk.
Yeah, as long as you can give me that, I will consider you as an entry and it's open to interpretation. No rules, really. Just hashtag defend the rush.
You can't cheat, obviously.
Yeah, please don't cheat. So yes, I guess that kind of finishes off everything quite nicely. We've had a long show here today. Thank you very much, Chad, for joining us.
No worries.
I think it's been
a good laugh. Drunk as fuck.
Whoa.
We don't drink, actually.
I'm going to go get drunk
as fuck. Let's go for a run.
We're going to go for a run and then bouldering.
But I'm down with bouldering. I'm so down with that.
So, yes, once again, thank you to the sponsors. Fnatic Gear, Space Jam, Darken, Twitch. It wouldn't be possible without them. Please check them out. Like every show and every esports bit of content you watch, it's down to the sponsors. We wouldn't be here. We wouldn't get paid. So you have to check them out. You have to support them. Please do that. And we've got one more show. This is the fifth show of six. This is our kind of pilot season. We've
got a lot planned for next year.
You've seen the level of content we can do. This is a demonstration, basically. This is not us at 100%. Obviously, we have a lot of different stuff going on. We cast every single CSGO event. We wanted to dedicate more time to this, but to do that, we need more money. So this is the pilot, show you what we can do. And I think we've done a pretty good job, all things considered. We're obviously working with Tom as well, who's been amazing. And we want to keep him on board, and he's not cheap. So we're going to try and do that. And yeah, thank you very much for ESL for lending us our studio. Joe Miller, Matt Klein especially as well. They made it happen, and it looks another time we pulled it out of nowhere, Matt. Last time we were a star ladder, they helped us out. This time,
dude, the studios look great. This is sick. Matt actually helped us set up our very first show as well with
sound. That's right. Yeah, he's been amazing.
Showing Tom how to stream some stuff. Yeah, he's been great. He's been awesome. He's actually the main producer of our shows for Pro League as well.
That's right. He took time out of his own day to do this. So thank you so much. Okay then, ladies and gentlemen, that's been Drop the Bomb episode 5. With a little fist bump to finish it off then. Boom. Drop the Bomb. Check it out next week. Thank you so much for watching, and goodbye.
We are gamers.
The timing works out perfectly just like that.